Hi, everybody. Thanks for joining us. So the webinar today is a very timely topic. Lots and lots of interest about this. Right plant, right place for low water landscapes. And today we have the privilege of hearing from a very dynamic duo, Amy Lentz and Alison O'Connor. You already saw their chair dancing skills, but just wait until you hear what they have to present. Alison is our Larimer County horticulture specialist, and Amy Lentz is in Weld County. And ladies, can't wait to hear what you have to say. Take it away.
All right. Thanks, Darren. Okay, so let's talk about right plant, right place. And we're going to focus today solely on those low water landscapes. So let's start out by just kind of going over some background information about the place that we live and what we're dealing with here. So here in Colorado, as you all probably know, we are a semi-arid state. We also have a lot of variation across the state in our climate. So whether you're in the mountains or on the eastern plains or out west, things are going to be a little bit different in each of those locations. There's also going to be variation maybe even within your own landscape with microclimates. We also have this pressure of increasing growth in Colorado. People love it here. They're coming out. And what that's going to do is it's going to put more and more demand on our water supply. Our governments are starting to look into this. Our cities and towns are starting to pay more attention. It's just becoming, as Darren mentioned, a really hot topic. And what we want to talk to you today about is choosing those right plants for those right places so that you can create an outdoor landscape that uses much less water, in some cases 60% or even more. You can have a fully unirrigated landscape with the right plant choices and helping them get established that first year. Just to give you an idea of some of this variability across the state, you know, if you're in Gunnison or Pueblo, you guys are getting less than 13 inches of rain a year, or precipitation, I should say. This includes rain and snow. Colorado Springs, about 17 and a half inches of precip a year. Durango and Boulder and Steamboat, you guys are getting a little bit more. Steamboat, almost to 24 inches, but that's still not a lot. So over in the East Coast, they're getting upwards of 35 to 40 inches of rain a year or precipitation a year. So when we're thinking about all these factors that we have to deal with, it's really great for us to think about considering plants that are adapted to our climate and adapted to these low water requirements. Instead of changing your landscape, let's change our plant palette to fit the landscape. John talked about this a lot last week, had some really great tips. And so today we're going to build on that and focus in on choosing those appropriate plants to reduce those water needs. And in turn, you're going to reduce the need for fertilizers and pesticides and things that you have to add for plants that aren't well adapted. So what does this right plant, right place really mean? There's a lot of things to think about, but the three main things are the purpose of the space. Is it fitting within that purpose that you're looking for? Is it the right plant? And then is it placed in the right spot? And then is it gonna have the right growing conditions to thrive? And so as you can see in this picture, beautiful, this is a crepe myrtle. This is obviously somewhere in the South, beautiful tree, bush, whatever you wanna call it, but this is not the right place for that plant. It is not fulfilling that purpose of space that it should be. If they wanted shade from this, it's not happening. It's right up against the house. So the second point there, plant selection and placement. This is not the right plant for this place either. I apologize that this picture is a little grainy, but what you can see here is a tree that was much too big for this space that would have gone into the power lines was chosen for this area. And so then they have to change their management to now make this plant fit within the landscape. So again, we're gonna try to do something a little different. Growing conditions. Should this plant be growing in this small of a space between a very narrow space between a sidewalk and a street? Probably not the right growing conditions for a tree. And in some cases, maybe you shouldn't have plants there at all. Is it something that can even support plant life? And so in this picture here, you can see this flooded out corner of the yard. I think there are bigger problems here than choosing the right plant. In this situation, there might be a hardscaping option that would be a better thing here. So pulling all this together, looking at that, all those factors, we want to look for height and width, mature size of these plants, making sure that we give them enough space when we plant them. thinking about the growth habit of those. Are they going to have enough room above them to make it, to give them what they need? And then you might also consider things like your root system. Is it shallow? Is it wide? Is it going to create surface roots? All of these things can help you choose the right plants for that right place. And this goes for trees and shrubs as well. It's not just your perennials. So we're thinking across our plant palette. When we look at those growing conditions, we're going to think about sun versus shade. Some plants are very intolerant of shade. Some plants are very intolerant of our heat, our high heat and sun intensity here. So getting them sited correctly in that sun and shade environment is important. Our soil conditions, as we mentioned last week, rather than trying to work against our soil, maybe we just want to choose things that are going to do well in clay or do well in sand. Do you have moisture pockets? Is there a certain spot in your yard maybe where you get a little bit more drainage? And so those plants might have just a little bit more water availability than other locations. And then you got to think about things like wind, slope, hardiness zone, and humidity. So we talked about this a little bit last week, and we just want to drive home this point again today. So we're going to be talking a lot about low water plants. These are things that are generally adapted to our native soils. And most of these low water and native plants are not going to want a highly amended soil. In fact, they're going to prefer that unamended soil, that lean soil that's pretty low in organic matter. So skip the compost around some of these, most of these low water and xeric type plants. Hydrozone your plants together, put them in different locations that have different watering requirements. So this is a picture, I think this is in Phoenix. This is a tall fescue irrigated lawn with saguaro cacti in it. The cacti might want 1 or 2 inches of rain, I don't know, every couple months. And then the lawn wants that much water every week. So obviously these two things are competing against each other. These are not the right plants for this place. Consider mulch. That's going to help you out a lot with your low water landscapes. Mulch is going to help with water conservation. It's going to improve the soil. It's going to help protect some of those plant roots that are under the ground, inhibiting weed competition. Please don't use weed fabric around a lot of these plants. It's just going to totally mess up the soil and not be the type of situation that you want. And then all over, if you put this mulch down, you're going to reduce that irrigation need by as much as 50%. Do you use rock mulch? Do you use wood mulch? It really depends on the plant. It depends on your design aesthetic, what you want to do. You could even do a combination of both, like you see in the picture, and then choose the plants to fit into those accordingly. Some plants do prefer that rock mulch. A lot of these low water plants, in fact, like that pea gravel type mulch. And then finally, think about maintenance. A low water landscape is not a no maintenance landscape. There's still going to be a few things that you need to do. The first year is really important with these low water plants. We need to get them established. We need to water them in and water them regularly that first season to help those roots set and get them going. After that, you can start to back off of that water. Depending on the plant, you may never have to water it again. It just depends, again, on that plant. Using that right mulch, again, will help prune these as you needed, but really these are meant to be a little bit more natural in their shape and form. And then let your plants reseed. Let things go like coneflower or hyssops or sedums, and they'll spread around and they'll find that niche that works for them. And they'll be the right plant for the right place. So we're going to cover a lot of different plants coming up for the rest of the class, but I do want to mention before we get started that there are tons of resources for you out there in terms of choosing the right plants and what's available to you. First, I think the greatest thing you can do is just go visit one of your local public gardens. There are xeric landscaping gardens all across Colorado. They're going to have plants that work here in your local area. They're going to have signage to help you identify those plants. And it's just a really great way to see what it actually looks like in the garden setting, as opposed to in a pot at the nursery. But local nurseries are also a really great resource. Our CSU Extension website has tons of fact sheets and plant talk articles, videos. We have garden notes. And we also have our cohorts blog, tons of videos there as well. Look at things like the Front Range tree recommendation list, look to plant select. We'll be covering plant select a lot in today's class, a lot of the plants that they offer. And then things like Colorado Native Plant Society, High Plains Environmental Center, and Resource Central. All of these places and these resources are out there for you to help you make your choices. So I'm going to turn it over to Alison, and she's going to get us started with some of the plants that you can grow in your low water landscape.
All right, thanks, Amy. Hey, everybody. It's good to have you with us on this Friday. And so we are going to really hit home these four big topics. Amy and I really struggled to get it down to a reasonable level of plants that we could actually teach in an hour. So trees, shrubs, perennials, and ornamental grasses. We aren't able to talk about tulips and our spring bulbs, but you should know that a lot of the spring blooming bulbs are very low water. We plant them in the fall, we'll water them a few times, but then they're using winter's moisture to actually bloom the following spring. So bulbs like these species tulips can be really drought tolerant. But next slide, we're going to start things off with trees. And so the first tree that we're going to talk about is coming up because I do want to tell you that trees are amazing. So we are in the middle of Arbor Day month. Next week is Colorado Arbor Day. The following Friday is National Arbor Day. And with trees, it's interesting because there are some amazing trees that can tolerate dry conditions, drought, and that's what we'll cover today. A good thing to keep in mind is that if you are planning to convert your landscape, maybe removing turf, maybe reducing water use, what you currently have planted, especially your trees, needs to be considered. The photo below is actually a green ash tree. So the one on the left is right after the turf adjacent to the tree was removed. And then the second picture is that tree a few years later. You can start to see some dieback happening. So if you make these radical changes or even minor changes, keep in mind what's existing there, because we don't want to lose a 20-year-old tree. We don't want to have to replace something and have to wait for that shade. So consider trees to be a very big investment. Next slide. So bur oak is our first one. I love the oaks, and it's hard to pick just one to talk about. Bur oak is great. We see it a lot on the Eastern Plains going into Nebraska, and it is considered to be a native tree species. For a lot of our urban landscapes, some of the bur oaks are going to get too big, but there's a lot of different variation in their sizes because for the most part, oaks are still propagated from seed. So if you've seen Ansel Adams, you've seen the big behemoth bur oaks, they can get very, very large. They have incredible acorns. Their fall color is maybe yellowish at best, but their acorns are almost completely covered by those fringe of scales. So bur oaks are a really wonderful tree to consider, very large shade tree. Next slide. The next tree is one that Amy is intimately familiar with because she grew up in Cincinnati, Kentucky, Cincinnati/Kentucky on the border. Gymnocladus dioicus is the Kentucky coffee tree. This is one that is absolutely incredible, but I do want to point out that on the far right in the middle slide, that is what it looks like when you're going to be purchasing it from a garden center. There's not a lot to it, but if you give it 5 to 7 to 9 years, it's going to develop into this incredible tree that you then see in the other pictures. So a really nice spreading crown. I feel it has interesting fruits, which are depicted in the far bottom right. And there are podless types available. They have super cute names like espresso and decaf. There is one that's been introduced that's better for smaller columnar spaces called skinny latte. But Kentucky coffee tree as a whole, very adaptable, drought tolerant, huge leaves, yellow fall color. It really checks most of the boxes as a great tree for our landscapes. A smaller tree to consider is the golden rain tree. Golden rain is phenomenal because it blooms in July. So we're talking a little bit later into the summer when it puts on a show. And when it's in bloom, it is absolutely covered in these bright yellow flowers. And then as they start to fade and shatter, they kind of trickle down to the ground, which is why it's called golden rain, because it really does seem like it's raining golden petals. The fruits then form and they almost look like lanterns or pods. They persist well into the fall and usually into the winter months. Again, fruits, acorns, pods, all of that is very subjective. So what I love, you may not dig, and we get that, but this is definitely a three-season tree. The one complaint I hear is that it might be a little weak wooded, so we might see some damage from heavy wet snows or winds. So good pruning is recommended for golden rain. The next one on the list is Tatarian maple. I'm sure most of you have heard of the cultivar, the introduction Hot Wings. It is a plant select introduction, one of the first plants that was introduced by the plant select program from Scott Skogerbo, who is the gentleman in the middle of the photo there. He's a propagator at Fort Collins Wholesale Nursery. And the Tatarian maple is a great tree. Now, it does prefer drier sites. If it's planted in wet feet or where maybe there's a little bit too much moisture, it is not going to perform. This tree was selected, the Hot Wings specifically, was selected because the fruits are the Samaras, the helicopter guys. They are a bright cherry red in the summer. So you have this, and you can see this in the photos, of these bright cherry red Samaras contrasting with the dark green leaves. This is definitely a smaller ornamental, so only about 20 by 20, and it does have a lot of great merits. It can be sold as a single stem, which is in the top right corner, or it could be sold as a clump. So there are some variations for this, but again, site selection, like Amy talked about, is absolutely critical for all of these trees. And I can't emphasize enough to make sure that you have the space to accommodate the tree at full maturity. That's so important. Tatarian maple also tends to get red fall color, which is wonderful. The next one is also a smaller ornamental, a serviceberry, and we do have native serviceberries in Colorado. So the Utahensis is actually one of the native species, but this is a three-season plant. It is phenomenal. Can't say enough good things. So in the spring, it has these beautiful white blossoms that actually cover the tree or large shrub, however you want to look at it, in its entirety. Those flowers develop into what tastes like blueberries. It's the closest thing that we can have in Colorado to blueberries, but it is unlikely that you will get to taste any because the birds absolutely love them. So it does have an edible fruit that looks a little bit like a blueberry. And then in the fall, there are some introductions like Autumn Brilliance that have been selected for really incredible fall color. So those cherries and those oranges that, if you grew up in the Midwest or another part of the United States on the East Coast, you might miss. We have a lot of amazing yellow fall color in Colorado, but not as much of those reds as anthocyanins that we so desperately want. So serviceberry is a great tree. Like the Hot Wings maple or the Tatarian maple we just met, it can be sold as a single stem or a clump. The one in the top picture is more of a clump, and so you can see how it can be a very large shrub. But serviceberry, one of my absolute favorite trees. It's readily available in the nursery trade and just fits such a nice space into the garden. So consider that one. Others that you can consider, that's the whirlwind tour of trees that we just covered, but other trees that you can consider and that are pictured here, the big tooth maple, that is a native species to Colorado. There are some newer cultivars that are coming out. The nice thing is A, it's a maple, which we don't have a lot of maples that we can promote, simply because some of them are finicky with our soils and pH. The big tooth is a great adapted tree. Also beautiful fall color, love that one. Sensation box elder is down in the lower left. That one also gets nice fall color. Don't be scared that I said box elder. It's a male clone, so it doesn't get any sort of samaras that encourage box elder bugs. And then the hawthorn, so Russian hawthorn, thornless cockspur, all of those are great choices. The flowers don't smell great, but they have a lot of really good merits. So I'm going to throw it. Oh, I have one more. Sorry about that. The pinyon pine. So we are going to just mention this as a potential evergreen. This is one site selection is so important because we don't want to put this in an area that gets regular irrigation. This is a native tree to the south. west part of Colorado. It's obviously our source of pine nuts. If you plant one tree, you're not going to make enough to get pesto. I apologize. It takes 2 years to develop those fruits too. So not very productive. But pinyon pine really loves hot, dry, sunny locations. It does not like lawn watering. It does not want to be overwatered. I've seen a lot more pinyons killed from too much water than a lack thereof. But the cones are cute. They look like little roses in bloom. So a lot of great things about the pinyon pine. And the needles, when you snap them, almost have like an orangey scent. So consider the pinion. A couple other evergreens, bristlecone, that's also known as the foxtail pine. You can go an elevation up to about 10 to 12,000 feet. So that's another native species. Ponderosa is native, generally gets maybe a little too big for urban areas. Ponderosa, unlike the spruce and the bristlecone pine, tends to shed its lower branches. That's just a natural adaptation to fires. So that's interesting. We would caution you against using the blue spruce and the white fir. The spruce tends to really prefer consistent moisture levels and maybe a little bit higher moisture, the same thing with the fir. So both are native, but they really like to have consistent moisture, not drought tolerant that we have found. So I'll throw it back to Amy.
All right, thanks, Alison. All right, let's shift gears a little bit, moving down in size. We're going to talk about a few shrubs that are going to do really good in these low water landscapes. I do want to mention that low water doesn't necessarily mean no water. You can get to a point with certain plants if you want to do a no water garden. That's great. We're focusing today on things that do need a little, some that do need a little bit of irrigation. So low water for most of these, especially these trees and shrubs, there aren't very, very few that could handle not being irrigated. But we're looking at reducing that irrigation. So let's talk about some shrubs. This slide here. The first one I want to mention is rabbit brush. So if you're from the eastern side of Colorado, especially up here around the northeastern part, you might actually see rabbit brush just growing along the roadsides. It is a great plant for here. It is a native plant to here. And since we've been, you know, growing these, we've come to find a couple of varieties or cultivars that we can use more in a home garden setting. And one of those would be baby blue rabbit brush. It's a plant select plant. It's a dwarf type. It's going to be 2 feet high, maybe 2 feet wide, as opposed to the original rabbit brush that's growing out there in the wild, which is 6 feet high and 6 feet wide. So if you're looking for that smaller native type shrub, this one is a great option. It's got beautiful yellow blooms and at the end of the season, and it is a great pollinator plant. We have a couple of these in our demonstration garden at Weld County. They're also behind me in my picture, and they are just covered in pollinators for a lot of the summer. Viburnum is another option that you could use. This one will be good if you have a little bit of shade that you're dealing with, dry shade in particular. There are a lot of different kinds. There's one called Mini Man, a little smaller up in the upper left. The wayfaring tree is the upper right corner picture there. And then we also have the leather leaf or the Allegheny, which is the lower picture there. The leather leaf might need just a little bit more water than the other ones, just because of its size. And it's a little bit more used to the eastern part of the United States. Depending on the type, these can get quite large for shrubs. So 12 feet high, 10 feet wide. So choose the one that works for you and for your space. But they have beautiful white flowers, really attractive leaves, thick leaves with these deep veins that are just really pretty to look at. So viburnum, one to try. One of my favorites is the manzanitas. There are a few for you to choose from. Arctostaphylos is the scientific name on these. But we have in the upper left there, we have Panchito. Next to it on the upper right is the Chieftain. The mock bearberry is down in the lower left. And then another one that's not, the rest of these are plant select, but there's another one called Kinnikinick that's in the lower right there. These are all broadleaf evergreen shrubs. They're gonna hold those leaves through the winter. Most of these are gonna prefer that full sun, some handling a little bit more part shade. the kinnikinick can handle that part shade quite well. But you know, this is one of those that you want to let it grow naturally. Let it spread into its space, come into its area. It does not really like to be pruned very much at all. They do get these really pretty pink waxy flowers that you can see in that picture of the panchito there. And then those will turn over into these nice red fruits toward the end of the season. The nice glossy green leaves are attractive, very uniform, and just, I think this is just a really good one. And this one can handle those low water conditions, those really low water conditions. Another one for you to consider is the Pawnee Butte Sand Cherry. This is a Colorado native selection. Sand cherries are native to Colorado. And this one was, I believe this one was selected up around the Pawnee Buttes National Grassland, which is how it kind of got its name. But it's a shrubby ground cover. So kind of similar to the manzanitas, it's going to want to spread out wide. It's not going to get very tall, but it's going to fill in a good space. And so, you know, 2 feet tall maybe, but 6 feet wide or more. So again, give it room, give it some space, plan accordingly when you plant this. Very drought tolerant, tough as nails. I have grown these in a very, very low water landscape. Again, watering the first year to get it established, but then you can back off and it will get used to that environment. Another one though that you just want to prune sparingly or not at all. If you don't need to prune it, don't prune it. And it's going to also give you some really nice fall color and pretty spring flowers as well. I want to touch on another one for the shadier parts of your landscape. This one is Oregon grape holly. This one in particular is aquifolium. It's more of a larger shrub, but there's another one that's more of a ground cover, which is repens, R-E-P-E-N-S. There's some debate going on in the name of this. I think it's getting moved over into a new category, so it may change from Mahonia to Berberis, but I don't know if that's happened yet. We'll see. But this is one of the few evergreens that we can grow that will tolerate that shade here in Colorado. If you're from the East Coast and you're used to seeing holly trees, this has a really similar look to a holly tree, except for the flowers and the berries are a little different. Yellow flowers and blue colored berries. So a really nice three-season plant, kind of like Alison mentioned earlier with the service berry. Just a really great one. And this one's going to, again, do well in that shade for you. I also want to mention junipers. I know junipers have, you know, we've been using junipers for a long time. They may be a little overused in certain cases, but they really do well in our landscape. They're very hardy. They're very versatile. You can get these in lots of different shapes, forms, sizes, growth habits, colors. So moving from left to right, we have the Woodward columnar juniper on the far left, a Wichita blue juniper in the second picture there. I think the third one is buffalo, I'm not quite sure. And then some sort of a creeping juniper there off to the far right. But the range here is really great. Very drought tolerant, lots of varieties for you to choose from, and evergreen. So they're gonna keep that green color year round. Other shrubs that then you can try for your dry sites, things like blue mist spirea, boulder raspberry, and butterfly bush, those all have nice flowering characteristics to them. I've got a picture here of the Carol Mackey Daphne. This one is a great option for low water landscapes. It's a little tough to establish, so you gotta give it a little extra care. Make sure you give it the right site. Common lilac is one. I wish we had time to cover all these shrubs, we just don't. But common lilac is one that you can put into a low water landscape. It should do pretty well. A lot of the homesteaders brought lilacs out when they came. And so there are lilac plantings around that are quite old and doing just fine with all of that they've had to endure in Colorado. Currants, desert holly, those are a couple other options. The Japanese barberry could be one. It does have thorns, so just keep that in mind. Little leaf mock orange, mountain lover, that's a nice evergreen, almost a ground cover. And then we have mugo pine, privet, nine bark, New Mexico privet, I should say, nine bark, potentilla, red twig dogwood, rock spirea. The snowberry is in the lower right there. That's a nice one with very interesting berries to it, really pretty leaf on it. Skunkbush sumac and yucca. So And this is not even the full list. There are still so many that you can incorporate into these drier sites. So Allison's going to come back on. We're going to move on into some sun-loving perennials, and we'll go from there.
Thank you, Amy. So sun perennials, these are the ones for the really hot, dry parts of your landscape. So we're talking full sun, probably a minimum of 8 hours a day, maybe 6 hours a day, and then all the way into like a southern exposure where they are getting blasted by the sun on a regular basis. So the first one we'll talk about, and we actually, what we consider to be like the three biggies, or the three first ones I'll talk about, is penstemon. This is also known as beard tongue. And what's incredible about penstemon is the diversity, both in the flower look and also the color. So the four we have listed here from left to right are Grand Mesa, then we have Pike's Peak, and you can see the little butts of those bees sticking out. This is an amazing pollinator plant. All of these are going to attract pollinators, which is incredible. Firecracker is the red one, and then Carolyn's Hope, which is one of my favorites. So it was introduced by the Plant Select program, and it was for one of the breeder's wives who was diagnosed with breast cancer. So a portion of this plant's proceeds do support the breast cancer research and science that is going on, but it's also that perfectly pink flower. It's just absolutely beautiful. So penstemons are one that if you're not growing them, I would strongly encourage you to consider. The height ranges from 1 to 3 feet tall, and there are a bunch of varieties. So this is where homework for you is key. Your local garden centers might sell many of them. Some of them may not be hardy, especially if you're doing mail order or ordering seeds or things like that. So lots of different varieties out there. About 60 or so are actually native to Colorado. So if you do hike in the forest and the mountains, you'll probably run into penstemon. Bloom time ranges from anywhere from late spring to early summer. They usually have several weeks of bloom on there. Hummingbirds love it, bees love it, and they do tend to be deer resistant. I have rabbits, I bet most of you do, and I haven't noticed that these are being chewed by rabbits, so I would throw rabbits in there as well. The thing with penstemon is they really don't care for really heavy soils, so do try to put them in an area that does have better drainage, but they don't need fertilizer, they don't need a lot of supplemental water. Once established, again, we have to say every plant needs regular water until they are established. Can't hit that home enough. And again, full sun. The next one we'll talk about is salvia. And just in terms of floriferous bloom, salvias are at the top of the list. So let's learn a little bit more about the salvias. These are considered to be the ornamental sages. So while we eat sage, right, we have that with our turkey or other things, it's a big genus. And so there are ornamental types, and there are also edible types. So just don't go munching on all the salvias because it may not be a good thing. This is in the mint family, which may send a chill down your spine because we know that anything in the mint family can be aggressive and spread. The good thing about this is because we're going to likely keep them on the drier side, right? These are hot, dry, drought tolerant perennials. You're not going to have that issue. And actually, if you overwater salvia, they can rot out and get kind of dead in the middle. So definitely once established, start to wean off the water and keep them on the drier side. Mixing them with penstemon is an awesome idea. They go naturally well together. They kind of complement their bloom season so that you have a longer period of bloom because the salvias will bloom later into the summer. And again, the diversity in the flower color, the look are numerous with salvia. It's great. Very tolerant to a wide variety of soils. So if you're battling more of a heavy clay or maybe a new landscape, it's going to work for you. Very pollinator friendly. And the three we have pictured here, so we have Windwalker Royal Red, that's a Plant Select introduction. And you can see that unique flower. So it's very different than its friend to the right, which is May Night Salvia. She's been around for a very long time. She was a perennial planted the year, a number of years ago, and really does well. Lots of blooms. What's cool about May Night Salvia is once she blooms for the first time, you can cut her back. by about half, and you'll get a second set of blooms, but not as much. And then in the lower bottom, we have the silver sage. The leaves, which you can barely see because we have so many white flowers, they're really large, they're fuzzy. This is a plant that gives you texture in the garden. So the flowers are just an added bonus, but the leaves themselves are really, really attractive. Our next perennial is hyssop, also known as agastache. That's how I pronounce it. These are fragrant in the landscape, which is really nice. So they smell a little bit like minty bubblegum. Some of them might smell like anise, that licorice flavor. Another one that is going to be super pollinator friendly with a huge diversity of flower colors that you have. So those three, the salvia, the hyssop, and the penstemon, are three that I think every garden should include in some way, shape, or form. Once established, you only need to water them rarely. And I have found that a couple of them gently reseed. So I have planted some hyssops, I let them complete their flower cycle, and then I find little baby hyssops the next year. They're not, by any stretch of the imagination, invasive. Okay, very easily controlled. So if they get out of where you want them, you can just remove them. Once the new growth emerges, this is really pretty true for all three of these plants. Once you start to see green at the base, you can cut back all of that, and then that will be what blooms the following or that season. The ones featured here, we have Sonoran Sunset, we have the blue hyssop, so that kind of bluish purple color, again, super pollinator friendly, and the fragrance is nice. Coneflower is one I think we're all familiar with, the echinacea. What's neat about coneflower is that we have a lot of breeding going into echinacea to make them just a little bit more interesting than the traditional lilac-y purple. Not that there's anything wrong with the old standard. Named appropriately because echinacea is Greek for hedgehog, and you can see how it got that name from kind of the center portion of the flower. This is a full sun plant. What you might find that happens is that echinacea does tend to reseed, and it can escape to areas of the landscape where you may not want it, or that could be a welcome addition. Just depends on what you want. I do recommend leaving the seed heads into the winter, fall and winter, just because it provides some interest. It provides a food source for some of the birds and other creatures, but very pollinator friendly. And a couple of cultivars for you to consider. These were all in the CSU perennial trials the last few years, and they have done exceedingly well. So again, what's great about echinacea is they have a really long, several weeks of bloom. They're a great cut flower. You can see how the flowers sit above the foliage, so you really get an impactful show. But there is a series called Kismet. That's that top left picture. So Kismet, there's a raspberry. There's a couple different ones. On the lower bottom, that's Sombrero Trace Amigos. And you can see that there's actually three different colors in there. So there's more of a magenta. There's a raspberry color. There's one that's a little bit darker. So just you get all the colors in one plant, which is great. And if you want something more cottage garden, you might go with Cheyenne Spirit, which again is going to have a mixture of colors with the yellows and the oranges and that kind of traditional lavender color. So coneflowers, look at them. There's more than just the standard purple. Hotflower oregano is one that's technically a ground cover. This is kind of a little guy. It might get about 18 inches tall, but this is grown because of the flowers. And so there's a bract, which you can see it's kind of that purpley green color. And then the flowers are those teeny tiny little purple guys. What's cool about hot flower oregano, this was a plant select introduction, I think back in maybe 2004. And it's great for cut flowers. It's pollinator friendly. It looks phenomenal in a rock garden or a crevice garden, or if you can position it over a retaining wall. And those bracts dry down and turn brown and look really great in the winter as well. Then in the spring, just cut it back when you start to see growth. It's just phenomenal. The next picture just shows off how cool this is. Again, it's more of a ground cover plant. It's not going to be 3 feet tall, but where it kind of fills in gaps in the garden, you can definitely use this. Hot full sun, pollinators love it. doesn't seem to be a rabbit problem, so consider the hot flower. And lavender, which of course I have featured behind me, lavender is an incredible plant for Colorado. It's really versatile. So obviously, lavender can be used for many reasons. It can be for edibles, like if you're using it in baked goods. We use it a lot, of course, in beauty products like soaps and shampoos. And then it's just so attractive. This is absolutely beautiful. I love it. Maybe you've made the mistake of planting Russian sage. I have. We all have made that mistake. Lavender could be a good substitute if you're ever able to fully remove Russian sage from your garden. This is an herb that thrives in our alkaline soils, so our soil type does not affect this plant. It can take more heavy soils, and Colorado just seems to be a great place to grow lavender. It is winter hardy, has great blooms. What I would recommend is that you plant this in the spring. We found that fall planted lavender may not do as well. It needs just a little bit more time to get established and re-establish its root system. So I would say if you plan on adding lavender, do it this spring or early in the summer, give it some water to get established and then go from there. And there is one that is so cute. It is called We One. This is a plant select introduction and it's only about 12 inches tall. So if you're planting the traditional English types, they're going to be maybe in bloom about 16, 18 inches tall, maybe 20 inches with the flowers, but Wee One is just so cute in the little rock garden crevices. Oh, she's adorable. Plant Wee One, you can see one of the penstemons tucked behind her shoulder there. Sedums and the stone crops, all of the succulents. So I'm going to cover the sedums and then I'll talk about one succulent. These are amazing plants, right? They have adapted to hot, dry conditions. They have the ability to store water, to get through those really tough periods. They're great for rock gardens. They're great for hypertufas. They're great just in the landscape. I love sedums and one might say I'm obsessed. It's true. Every time I see a sedum in a garden center, I cannot pass it up. So I purchase it and then tuck it in. They can tolerate the poor rocky soils, but they can also do well in the typical clay too. A lot of them are ground covers. We have a couple that are more ornamentals that get to be about knee high. The ground cover types have flowers that I don't love them, but they are cute. I just like the foliage because they're so unique. You can see this diversity of the foliage where we have ones that are maybe a little more cupped and then we have that some that look more like rosettes. And the flowers do attract bees if you want to keep them. So a couple of different cultivars that you can consider. Winter Fire is my new obsession. This is what it looks like in the winter months. So it's green, like a dark green, like a CSU green during the summer. And then it gets this beautiful red fall color. Who would ever think that would happen with a sedum? Turquoise tails is another plant select introduction. Again, the flowers, you may love them, you may not like them. Planted with the agave in the background, hello, it's amazing. But turquoise tails is more of a, let's say like kind of a clumpy, very unique structure. Autumn Joy is one of the ones that gets to be about knee tall. And what's great about Autumn Joy is it blooms later on into the fall. So this is one that blooms in August or September. Great pollinator plant because at that point we may not have a lot of flowers left in our garden. Those flower heads are huge and heavy. They're almost like cabbages sitting on top of a plant. And they do persist into the winter months, which is wonderful. So you get that really nice winter structure. And then Angelina, you've probably heard of during the summer, she is a bright lime green. And then in the fall and winter, she gets these russets and oranges and just phenomenal. Angelina, Winter Fire together, I think it'd be an incredible duo. So anyway, a couple of sedums for you to consider. And then I do want to call attention to the hens and chicks, because if you want to start collecting something, maybe this is the collection for you. At least it is for me. There is a bunch of hen and chicks that have been introduced under the name Chick Charms. And there's a ton of diversity to them. You can just see the kind of diversity. So different variegation, different looks. They have super fun names like Mint Marvel and Appletini. There's one called like Cherry Cordial. They are great. They are commonly found in the garden center. You can find the sedums or the hens and chicks there. They have the typical hens and chicks, but maybe add some of these just for a little bit of diversity. And then I will wrap up with just a couple of grasses and some other suggestions of plants. Blonde Ambition Blue Grandma is a great grass, 36 inches tall. This is a native, a selected native. Does great in unirrigated areas, but cannot tolerate the shade. This has been planted everywhere. You will run into this in your travels among the Front Range and beyond. Really hardy up to 9,500 feet as well. And then the next grass is switchgrass. This is panicum. Great grasses, lots of different cultivars like Heavy Metal and Shenandoah, which is in the lower right. Northwind was introduced by the University of Minnesota. Nice narrow form, very respectful, does not spread, which is good. And then the flowers look like fireworks dancing or cotton candy being spun above those grasses. About 5 feet tall though, so do make sure that you have adequate room for this one. And a few more grasses for sun areas. Amy will cover those in shade. Blue oak grass, little blue stem, that's another native. So there's big blue stem, little blue stem. They do get some nice fall color, which you can see there. Prairie drop seed, kind of a mop top, really, really cool. And then Indian grass. So these are all full sun grasses. We have a great fact sheet on ornamental grasses that John, Darren, or Lisa could pop into the chat for you. So do check those out and then select one that works best for your conditions.
All right. Great, Alison. Thanks for the sun-loving perennials. Let's talk a little bit about some shade-loving perennials. So dry shade is one of those areas that it's a niche and it's hard to sometimes think of plants that you can put into a dry shade situation. Let's start out with Denver Gold Columbine. I love this plant. I love columbine in general. You know, it is our state flower. This yellow form though, called Denver Gold, one thing that makes it different from the normal Rocky Mountain columbine is that it blooms almost the whole summer from June through September. It much longer than your blues and your reds. You can also cut those blooms back periodically. That can help encourage new blooms. It is a native to the Southwest. It is a plant selection. Just a really nice, good way to have some pop of color, some brightness in those shady areas. You know, when you look at that lower picture there, your eye is drawn toward those yellow flowers, and it really makes you not want to look back at that dark understory shade area. It just gives it that bright pop that the area needs. Another columbine that you could use, this is another plant select variety, is Swan Violet and White, or called Remembrance. This one is much better in the part shade. The Denver Gold can actually go either way, sun or shade. This one likes to have a little bit more shade than that. Not quite as tall, but man, those flowers are striking. They have that really deep, dark purple toward the back on the bracts, and then those white petals and that yellow center just really showing off very well. These will benefit from a little bit of moisture, but one thing to think about with shade is that you're going to get that moisture retention just for the fact that you're in the shade. So, but giving these just a little bit of irrigation can help give them a bigger and better display, but they will also do okay with a lack of water too. Johnson's Blue Cranesbill. This is kind of a one-off plant. This one here that we want to mention, really great plant, full sun to full shade. So a big range again here in where it can grow, and it can fit that niche. It's going to also bloom late spring and then last all the way up into early fall. So giving you that full season of color, beautiful little periwinkle blue flowers. The leaves are very attractive with their finely cut pattern to them. It does get a little bit of fall color. This one does like that sandy soil or just a more normal soil. But, you know, I've seen this one grown in so many different locations, and it seems to be very well adapted. So Johnson's Blue, this is a perennial geranium. It's not the typical annual geraniums that you're buying, you know, to put into your hanging baskets. This is a perennial type. So Johnson's Blue, give that one a try. One of my favorites for the dry shade garden is Coral Bells. And as you can see, the variety of options here, there's just so many. So sun to full shade again, really they like that shade more so. You'll get a more vibrant color in the shade, especially with some of these lime and yellow types. Very attractive leaves. There's been a lot of breeding going on with these type of plants. There's a nursery on the West Coast called Terra Nova. I had I was just so lucky to get to go visit it. And the plants that they're creating there, it's like they can come up with another one. And then there's another one. Some of these have variegated leaves. Some are dark purple. Some are pink. Some are green. It's just so many things you could do. You could have a whole section with just coral bells and really make it look really kind of cool. Let's see. So you can cut those flowers off. They do sit above the foliage, maybe up to 18 inches. You can cut those off periodically. That can help extend that bloom time. But like some of the other plants Alison mentioned, these are really grown more for the foliage. One of my favorites is the one up here in the upper left. That's Snow Angels Coral Bells. Palace Purple is the one off to the right here. And then just, again, so many others. Here's some of those options for you. There's that Snow Angel again. Palace Purple is a very popular one. And then there's this Carnival series with these really nice leaves with kind of this mottled look to them, and Lime Marmalade. Again, if you want to add that brightness into your shade, choose these yellows and lime greens to do that. Siberian Bug Gloss or Brunnera is another option. Now there is a Brunnera that's a little bit more invasive. This is a different kind. It's a Siberian Bug Gloss. Particularly this one called Jack Frost. And these are great. These will do great in part to full shade. They'll be more of like a ground cover, like a large leaf ground cover if you plant them in mass. Little tiny blue flowers that are just so delicate and dainty, and they come in the spring and you just love them. But then once those flowers kind of fade, you've got that beautiful variegated foliage behind it to carry you through the rest of the season with some interest. Very hardy here. Again, Jack Frost is the one up here in the top. And then Alexander's Great was a winner of the CSU trials that have much bigger leaves. Lady's Mantle, another one for the dry shade garden. This one has nice, big, large, fuzzy leaves. And if you do water or we get a little bit of rain, the water droplets sit on the top of those leaves and they shine and they become a little bit iridescent. And it's just really a cool thing to see. Little chartreuse flowers sitting above that, not too noticeable. Those will happen in the early summer, but this is just a really nice, can handle that full shade, can handle those drought conditions. Lady's Mantle is definitely one to try. And then one of my favorites is hardy plumbago or leadwort. I have this one growing at my house and it loves the shade. It's a nice little plant. Green leaves, bright blue flowers. It will hold its blooms all through the summer into the fall. And then you get this pop of red color at the end of the season. And that red against that blue, it just really stands out. This one can also be grown as a ground cover. It likes our soils. It likes any kind of soils, really pretty adaptable and pretty low water once you get this one established. Like some of the ones Alison mentioned, plant this in the spring, like you do your lavender, it's gonna help it establish that root system better. And then finally, just a few grasses for your dry shade areas. Blue fescues can handle partial shade. That's the picture up here in the upper left. Blue oat is kind of a bigger version of the blue fescue, a little bigger there. Korean feather reed grass, you can get that one. It'll do great in partial shade. The little blue stem Alison mentioned will do good in the sun. It will also take some light shade. We have overdam reed grass here on my lower left. That's a variegated form of our friend Carl Forrester. So if you have Carl Forrester reed grass, you'll see it everywhere. It's green on the bottom and kind of a straw color on the top where the seed heads are. And it's just a lot overplanted. And so the overdam could be a nice option to replace the Carl Forster. And the variegation will show up better in the shade. The shade kind of brightens those colors, more saturation to those colors. And then the lower right there, again, prairie drop seed. So good for the sun, but can also handle that light shade as well. So we're going to wrap it up with our last couple minutes. We just want to remind you about right plant, right place. And what does it really mean? It means using that space, finding the purpose of that space, choosing the right plants, and then placing them where they want to be. Instead of modifying your landscape, let's just modify our plant palette and work with our gardens instead of against them, making sure that they have the growing conditions that they need. Again, I just want to mention that we've got several resources out there. Go visit those public gardens. We've shown you a few pictures today where you can go and see those. You can also find on Plant Select's website, they have a list of Plant Select gardens around the state. Most Plant Select plants are going to be low water, highly adapted. And so you can find out where there is a Plant Select Xeric garden near you and then go visit. Tons of stuff from CSU. Check out our blog. I'm going to bring Alison back on and our panel. Do we have any last minute things we need to cover or questions that are still hanging out there?
I just want to remind people that this was recorded. If you're on this webinar, you've registered and you'll get the recording within a week or so.
Hey, Amy, since you're the dry shade person, we did have one just come in. And yeah. How about a shady spot that the only sun it gets is in the afternoon when it's that blazing western sun? Any thoughts about your favorite plants for that sort of situation?
Yeah, in fact, some of the ones that are sun loving will actually do probably better than a shade loving plant in that situation. I have grown on my west facing, the penstemons are gonna love that hot, hot afternoon sun, and they can actually handle just a little bit of that morning shade just fine. So you could try penstemons. Some of the bulbs would be great in that situation. But I think in the case of an afternoon sun, that's going to be more impactful than the little bit of shade it gets in the morning. So let's choose more sun-loving plants for those areas.
Thanks, Amy. And then maybe for both of you to weigh in on, Deborah would like to know, in terms of watering, do you recommend a drip system or some other kind of sprinkler system? How should we water things when they do need water?
Well, I know what John would recommend, and that would be no irrigation system, which I think
that's why I asked you.
Yes, and I think that's definitely an option. As we've talked about today, you really need to water these the first year to get them established. If you can do that by hand, and you might be watering maybe once a week, maybe a couple times a week right after planting, but then maybe backing off to once a week and then just kind of tapering it down every couple weeks, you can eventually get to where that landscape will sustain itself. You'll lose some plants along the way. You'll replace them with more drought tolerant plants. And that's how you get to that zero water situation. But you can absolutely do drip on your low water landscape. You just want to make sure it's on its own zone so that you can turn it off when you need to, because you're going to be turning it off more than you're going to be turning it on. Alison, what do you think? Any other tips there?
No, that covered it perfectly.
Yeah. You can also use like a sprinkler, overhead sprinkler type situation. You just don't want to be doing that very often to where it's getting overwatered. So I have seen that too. But always backing off after they get established. All right. I've put Alison and I's contact information on the screen. You can contact us with any additional questions. We will be, you'll be getting a follow-up email tomorrow, asking you to fill out our survey, let us know how we're doing, give us those tips of what else you want to learn about. And I suppose we will see you all next week for What's Bugging You with Lisa. So thank you everyone for joining, and we'll take you out with a little bit more of our fun music so we can all keep dancing. Have a good weekend. Hey. Welcome everyone to our webinar today. We're so glad you could join us. Let me go ahead and get started with a few housekeeping items. We are offering closed captioning for this webinar. If you need that, you can do that through the controls on your screen through Zoom. We are also an equal opportunity access and non-discrimination university at Colorado State. And if you want to learn more about our principles of community or our land acknowledgement statement, or if we can provide services to you, just reach out to us or visit our website at colostate.edu. We will be recording today's class. It'll take us about a week to get that recording posted. It will go up on our cohorts blog, where you also the same place where you registered for this class. As we go along today, there probably will be some questions. And so just please put those into the Q&A section. And we will be probably closing the chat down. So just put those in the Q&A. And let me go ahead and skip to our next slide and let you know that we do have still some more classes coming up. Next week, we'll be doing beetles bugging you. We have edible landscaping at the end of the month. And then the first week of May, we'll do all about trees. Let me go ahead and introduce our panel for you. We have Lisa Mason. She is our horticultural specialist in Arapahoe County. She'll be teaching you next week, right, with beetles bugging you. We have John Mergel. You heard from him last week on the proven xeriscape practices. He's our hort specialist down in Douglas County. And then we have Darren Davidson, our statewide sustainable landscaping specialist with us today. And she's going to help us out too. All of them will be working on that Q&A, a very expert panel for you to ask your questions to. I'm going to turn it over to Darren. She's going to do some introductions and then we'll get started.
Thanks, Amy. Hi, everybody. Thanks for joining us. So the webinar today is a very timely topic. Lots and lots of interest about this. Right plant, right place for low water landscapes. And today we have the privilege of hearing from a very dynamic duo, Amy Lentz and Alison O'Connor. You already saw their chair dancing skills, but just wait until you hear what they have to present. Alison is our Larimer County horticulture specialist, and Amy Lentz is in Weld County. And ladies, can't wait to hear what you have to say. Take it away.
All right. Thanks, Darren. Okay, so let's talk about right plant, right place. And we're going to focus today solely on those low water landscapes. So let's start out by just kind of going over some background information about the place that we live and what we're dealing with here. So here in Colorado, as you all probably know, we are a semi-arid state. We also have a lot of variation across the state in our climate. So whether you're in the mountains or on the eastern plains or out west, things are going to be a little bit different in each of those locations. There's also going to be variation maybe even within your own landscape with microclimates. We also have this pressure of increasing growth in Colorado. People love it here. They're coming out. And what that's going to do is it's going to put more and more demand on our water supply. Our governments are starting to look into this. Our cities and towns are starting to pay more attention. It's just becoming, as Darren mentioned, a really hot topic. And what we want to talk to you today about is choosing those right plants for those right places so that you can create an outdoor landscape that uses much less water, in some cases 60% or even more. You can have a fully unirrigated landscape with the right plant choices and helping them get established that first year. Just to give you an idea of some of this variability across the state, if you're in Gunnison or Pueblo, you guys are getting less than 13 inches of rain a year, or precipitation, I should say. This includes rain and snow. Colorado Springs, about 17 and a half inches of precip a year. Durango and Boulder and Steamboat, you guys are getting a little bit more. Steamboat, almost to 24 inches, but that's still not a lot. So over in the East Coast, they're getting upwards of 35 to 40 inches of rain a year or precipitation a year. So when we're thinking about all these factors that we have to deal with, It's really great for us to think about considering plants that are adapted to our climate and adapted to these low water requirements. Instead of changing your landscape, let's change our plant palette to fit the landscape. John talked about this a lot last week, had some really great tips. And so today we're going to build on that and focus in on choosing those appropriate plants to reduce those water needs. And in turn, you're going to reduce the need for fertilizers and pesticides and things that you have to add for plants that aren't well adapted. So what does this right plant, right place really mean? There's a lot of things to think about, but the three main things are the purpose of the space. Is it fitting within that purpose that you're looking for? Is it the right plant? And then is it placed in the right spot? And then is it gonna have the right growing conditions to thrive? And so as you can see in this picture, beautiful, this is a crepe myrtle. This is obviously somewhere in the South. Beautiful tree, bush, whatever you wanna call it, but this is not the right place for that plant. It is not fulfilling that purpose of space that it should be. If they wanted shade from this, it's not happening. It's right up against the house. So the second point there, plant selection and placement. This is not the right plant for this place either. I apologize that this picture is a little grainy, but what you can see here is a tree that was much too big for this space that would have gone into the power lines was chosen for this area. And so then they have to change their management to now make this plant fit within the landscape. So again, we're gonna try to do something a little different. Growing conditions. Should this plant be growing in this small of a space between a very narrow space between a sidewalk and a street? Probably not the right growing conditions for a tree. And in some cases, maybe you shouldn't have plants there at all. Is it something that can even support plant life? And so in this picture here, you can see this flooded out corner of the yard. I think there are bigger problems here than choosing the right plant. In this situation, there might be a hardscaping option that would be a better thing here. So pulling all this together, looking at that, all those factors, we want to look for height and width, mature size of these plants, making sure that we give them enough space when we plant them. Thinking about the growth habit of those, are they going to have enough room above them to make it, to give them what they need? And then you might also consider things like your root system. Is it shallow? Is it wide? Is it going to create surface roots? All of these things can help you choose the right plants for that right place. And this goes for trees and shrubs as well. It's not just your perennials. So we're thinking across our plant palette. When we look at those growing conditions, we're going to think about sun versus shade. Some plants are very intolerant of shade. Some plants are very intolerant of our heat, our high heat and sun intensity here. So getting them sited correctly in that sun and shade environment is important. Our soil conditions, as we mentioned last week, rather than trying to work against our soil, maybe we just wanna choose things that are gonna do well in clay or do well in sand. Do you have moisture pockets? Is there a certain spot in your yard maybe where you get a little bit more drainage. And so those plants might have just a little bit more water availability than other locations. And then you got to think about things like wind, slope, hardiness zone, and humidity. So we talked about this a little bit last week, and we just want to drive home this point again today. So we're going to be talking a lot about low water plants. These are things that are generally adapted to our native soils. And most of these low water and native plants are not going to want a highly amended soil. In fact, they're going to prefer that unamended soil, that lean soil that's pretty low in organic matter. So skip the compost around some of these, most of these low water and xeric type plants. Hydrozone your plants together, put them in different locations that have different watering requirements. So this is a picture, I think this is in Phoenix. This is a tall fescue irrigated lawn with saguaro cacti in it. The cacti might want 1 or 2 inches of rain, I don't know, every couple months. And then the lawn wants that much water every week. So obviously these two things are competing against each other. These are not the right plants for this place. consider mulch. That's going to help you out a lot with your low water landscapes. Mulch is going to help with water conservation. It's going to improve the soil. It's going to help protect some of those plant roots that are under the ground, inhibiting weed competition. Please don't use weed fabric around a lot of these plants. It's just going to totally mess up the soil and not be the type of situation that you want. And then all over, if you put this mulch down, you're going to reduce that irrigation need by as much as 50%. Do you use rock mulch? Do you use wood mulch? It really depends on the plant. It depends on your design aesthetic, what you want to do. You could even do a combination of both, like you see in the picture, and then choose the plants to fit into those accordingly. Some plants do prefer that rock mulch. A lot of these low water plants, in fact, like that pea gravel type mulch. And then finally, think about maintenance. A low water landscape is not a no maintenance landscape. There's still going to be a few things that you need to do. The first year is really important with these low water plants. We need to get them established. We need to water them in and water them regularly that first season to help those roots set and get them going. After that, you can start to back off of that water. Depending on the plant, you may never have to water it again. It just depends, again, on that plant. Using that right mulch, again, will help prune these as you needed, but really these are meant to be a little bit more natural in their shape and form. And then let your plants reseed. Let things go like coneflower or hyssops or sedums, and they'll spread around and they'll find that niche that works for them, and they'll be the right plant for the right place. So we're going to cover a lot of different plants coming up for the rest of the class, but I do want to mention before we get started that there are tons of resources for you out there in terms of choosing the right plants and what's available to you. First, I think the greatest thing you can do is just go visit one of your local public gardens. There are xeric landscaping gardens all across Colorado. They're going to have plants that work here in your local area. They're going to have signage to help you identify those plants. And it's just a really great way to see what it actually looks like in the garden setting, as opposed to in a pot at the nursery. But local nurseries are also a really great resource. Our CSU Extension website has tons of fact sheets and plant talk articles, videos. We have garden notes, and we also have our cohorts blog, tons of videos there as well. Look at things like the Front Range tree recommendation list. Look to Plant Select. We'll be covering Plant Select a lot in today's class, a lot of the plants that they offer. And then things like Colorado Native Plant Society, High Plains Environmental Center, and Resource Central. All of these places and these resources are out there for you to help you make your choices. So I'm going to turn it over to Alison, and she's going to get us started with some of the plants that you can grow in your low water landscape.
All right, thanks, Amy. Hey, everybody. It's good to have you with us on this Friday. And so we are going to really hit home these four big topics. Amy and I really struggled to get it down to a reasonable level of plants that we could actually teach in an hour. So trees, shrubs, perennials, and ornamental grasses. We aren't able to talk about tulips and our spring bulbs, but you should know that a lot of the spring blooming bulbs are very low water. We plant them in the fall, we'll water them a few times, but then they're using winter's moisture to actually bloom the following spring. So bulbs like these species tulips can be really drought tolerant. But next slide, we're going to start things off with trees. And so the first tree that we're going to talk about is coming up because I do want to tell you that trees are amazing. So we are in the middle of Arbor Day month. Next week is Colorado Arbor Day. The following Friday is National Arbor Day. And with trees, it's interesting because there are some amazing trees that can tolerate dry conditions, drought, and that's what we'll cover today. A good thing to keep in mind is that if you are planning to convert your landscape, maybe removing turf, maybe reducing water use, what you currently have planted, especially your trees, needs to be considered. The photo below is actually a green ash tree. So the one on the left is right after the turf adjacent to the tree was removed. And then the second picture is that tree a few years later. You can start to see some dieback happening. So if you make these radical changes or even minor changes, keep in mind what's existing there, because we don't want to lose a 20-year-old tree. We don't want to have to replace something and have to wait for that shade. So consider trees to be a very big investment. Next slide. So bur oak is our first one. I love the oaks, and it's hard to pick just one to talk about. Bur oak is great. We see it a lot on the eastern plains going into Nebraska, and it is considered to be a native tree species. For a lot of our urban landscapes, some of the bur oaks are going to get too big, but there's a lot of different variation in their sizes because for the most part, oaks are still propagated from seed. So if you've seen Ansel Adams, you've seen the big behemoth bur oaks, they can get very, very large. They have incredible acorns. Their fall color is maybe yellowish at best, but their acorns are almost completely covered by those fringe of scales. So bur oaks are a really wonderful tree to consider, very large shade tree. Next slide. The next tree is one that Amy is intimately familiar with because she grew up in Cincinnati, Kentucky, Cincinnati/Kentucky on the border. Gymnocladus dioicus is the Kentucky coffee tree. This is one that is absolutely incredible, but I do want to point out that on the far right in the middle slide, that is what it looks like when you're going to be purchasing it from a garden center. There's not a lot to it, but if you give it 5 to 7 to 9 years, it's going to develop into this incredible tree that you then see in the other pictures. So a really nice spreading crown. I feel it has interesting fruits, which are depicted in the far bottom right. And there are podless types available. They have super cute names like Espresso and Decaf. There is one that's been introduced that's better for smaller columnar spaces called Skinny Latte. But Kentucky coffee tree as a whole, very adaptable, drought tolerant, huge leaves, yellow fall color. It really checks most of the boxes as a great tree for our landscapes. A smaller tree to consider is the golden rain tree. Golden rain is phenomenal because it blooms in July. So we're talking a little bit later into the summer when it puts on a show. And when it's in bloom, it is absolutely covered in these bright yellow flowers. And then as they start to fade and shatter, they kind of trickle down to the ground, which is why it's called golden rain, because it really does seem like it's raining golden petals. The fruits then form, and they almost look like lanterns or pods. They persist well into the fall and usually into the winter months. Again, fruits, acorns, pods, all of that is very subjective. So what I love, you may not dig, and we get that, but this is definitely a three-season tree. The one complaint I hear is that it might be a little weak wooded, so we might see some damage from heavy wet snows or winds, so good pruning is recommended for golden rain. The next one on the list is Tatarian maple. I'm sure most of you have heard of the cultivar, the introduction Hot Wings. It is a plant select introduction, one of the first plants that was introduced by the plant select program from Scott Skogerbo, who is the gentleman in the middle of the photo there. He's a propagator at Fort Collins Wholesale Nursery. And the Tatarian maple is a great tree. Now, it does prefer drier sites. If it's planted in wet feet or where maybe there's a little bit too much moisture, it is not going to perform. This tree was selected, the Hot Wings specifically, was selected because the fruits are the Samaras, the helicopter guys. They are a bright cherry red in the summer. So you have this, and you can see this in the photos, of these bright cherry red Samaras contrasting with the dark green leaves. This is definitely a smaller ornamental, so only about 20 by 20. And it does have a lot of great merits. It can be sold as a single stem, which is in the top right corner, or it could be sold as a clump. So there are some variations for this, but again, site selection, like Amy talked about, is absolutely critical for all of these trees. And I can't emphasize enough to make sure that you have the space to accommodate the tree at full maturity. That's so important. Tatarian maple also tends to get red fall color, which is wonderful. The next one is also a smaller ornamental, a serviceberry, and we do have native serviceberries in Colorado. So the Utahensis is actually one of the native species. but this is a three-season plant. It is phenomenal. Can't say enough good things. So in the spring, it has these beautiful white blossoms that actually cover the tree or a large shrub, however you want to look at it, in its entirety. Those flowers develop into what tastes like blueberries. It's the closest thing that we can have in Colorado to blueberries, but it is unlikely that you will get to taste any because the birds absolutely love them. So it does have an edible fruit that looks a little bit like a blueberry. And then in the fall, there are some introductions like Autumn Brilliance that have been selected for really incredible fall color. So those cherries and those oranges that if you grew up in the Midwest or another part of the United States on the East Coast, you might miss. We have a lot of amazing yellow fall color in Colorado, but not as much of those reds, those anthocyanins that we so desperately want. So serviceberry is a great tree. Like the hot wings maple or the Tatarian maple we just met, it can be sold as a single stem or a clump. The one in the top picture is more of a clump, and so you can see how it can be a very large shrub. But serviceberry, one of my absolute favorite trees. It's readily available in the nursery trade and just fits such a nice space into the garden. So consider that one. Others that you can consider, that's the whirlwind tour of trees that we just covered, but other trees that you can consider and that are pictured here, the big tooth maple, that is a native species to Colorado. There are some newer cultivars that are coming out. The nice thing is A, it's a maple, which we don't have a lot of maples that we can promote, simply because some of them are finicky with our soils and pH. The big tooth is a great adapted tree. Also beautiful fall color, love that one. Sensation box elder is down in the lower left. That one also gets nice fall color. Don't be scared that I said box elder. It's a male clone, so it doesn't get any sort of samaras that encourage box elder bugs. And then the hawthorn, so Russian hawthorn, thornless cockspur, all of those are great choices. The flowers don't smell great, but they have a lot of really good merits. So I'm going to throw it. Oh, I have one more. Sorry about that. The pinyon pine. So we are going to just mention this as a potential evergreen. This is one site selection is so important because we don't want to put this in an area that gets regular irrigation. This is a native tree to the southwest part of Colorado. It's obviously our source of pine nuts. If you plant one tree, you're not going to make enough to get pesto. I apologize. It takes 2 years to develop those fruits too. So not very productive. But pinyon pine really loves hot, dry, sunny locations. It does not like lawn watering. It does not want to be overwatered. I've seen a lot more pinions killed from too much water than a lack thereof. But the cones are cute. They look like little roses in bloom. So a lot of great things about the pinyon pine. And the needles, when you snap them, almost have like an orangey scent. So consider the pinion. A couple other evergreens, bristlecone, that's also known as the foxtail pine. You can go an elevation up to about 10 to 12,000 feet. So that's another native species. Ponderosa is native, generally gets maybe a little too big for urban areas. Ponderosa, unlike the spruce and the bristlecone pine, tends to shed its lower branches. That's just a natural adaptation to fires. So that's interesting. We would caution you against using the blue spruce and the white fir. The spruce tends to really prefer consistent moisture levels and maybe a little bit higher moisture, the same thing with the fir. So both are native, but they really like to have consistent moisture, not drought tolerant that we have found. So I'll throw it back to Amy.
All right, thanks, Alison. All right, let's shift gears a little bit, moving down in size. We're going to talk about a few shrubs that are going to do really good in these low water landscapes. I do want to mention that low water doesn't necessarily mean no water. You can get to a point with certain plants if you want to do a no water garden. That's great. We're focusing today on things that do need a little, some that do need a little bit of irrigation. So low water for most of these, especially these trees and shrubs, there aren't very, very few that could handle not being irrigated. So but we're looking at reducing that irrigation. So let's talk about some shrubs. This slide here. The first one I want to mention is rabbit brush. So if you're from the eastern side of Colorado, especially up here around the northeastern part, you might actually see rabbit brush just growing along the roadsides. It is a great plant for here. It is a native plant to here. And since we've been, you know, growing these, we've come to find a couple of varieties or cultivars that we can use more in a home garden setting. And one of those would be baby blue rabbit brush. It's a plant select plant. It's a dwarf type. It's going to be 2 feet high, maybe 2 feet wide, as opposed to the original rabbit brush that's growing out there in the wild, which is 6 feet high and 6 feet wide. So if you're looking for that smaller native type shrub, this one is a great option. It's got beautiful yellow blooms in, at the end of the season, and it is a great pollinator plant. We have a couple of these in our demonstration garden at Weld County. They're also behind me in my picture, and they are just covered in pollinators for a lot of the summer. Viburnum is another option that you could use. This one will be good if you have a little bit of shade that you're dealing with, dry shade in particular. There are a lot of different kinds. There's one called Mini Man, a little smaller up in the upper left. The Wayfaring Tree is the upper right corner picture there. And then we also have the Leather Leaf or the Allegheny, which is the lower picture there. The Leather Leaf might need just a little bit more water than the other ones, just because of its size. And it's a little bit more used to the eastern part of the United States. Depending on the type, these can get quite large for shrubs, so 12 feet high, 10 feet wide. So choose the one that works for you and for your space. But they have beautiful white flowers, really attractive leaves, thick leaves with these deep veins that are just really pretty to look at. So viburnum, one to try. One of my favorites is the manzanitas. There are a few for you to choose from. Arctostaphylos is the scientific name on these. But we have in the upper left there, we have Panchito. Next to it on the upper right is the Chieftain. The Mock Bearberry is down in the lower left. And then another one that's not, the rest of these are plant select, but there's another one called Kinnikinick that's in the lower right there. These are all broadleaf evergreen shrubs. They're gonna hold those leaves through the winter. Most of these are gonna prefer that full sun, some handling a little bit more part shade. The Kinnikinick can handle that part shade quite well. But you know, this is one of those that you want to let it grow naturally. Let it spread into its space, come into its area. It does not really like to be pruned very much at all. They do get these really pretty pink waxy flowers that you can see in that picture of the Panchito there. And then those will turn over into these nice red fruits toward the end of the season. The nice glossy green leaves are attractive, very uniform, and just, I think this is just a really good one. And this one can handle those low water conditions, those really low water conditions. Another one for you to consider is the Pawnee Butte Sand Cherry. This is a Colorado native selection. Sand cherries are native to Colorado. And this one was, I believe this one was selected up around the Pawnee Butte's national grassland, which is how it kind of got its name. But it's a shrubby ground cover. So kind of similar to the manzanitas, it's going to want to spread out wide. It's not going to get very tall, but it's going to fill in a good space. And so, you know, 2 feet tall maybe, but 6 feet wide or more. So again, give it room, give it some space, plan accordingly when you plant this. Very drought tolerant, tough as nails. I have grown these in a very, very low water landscape. Again, watering the first year to get it established, but then you can back off and it will get used to that environment. Another one though that you just want to prune sparingly or not at all, if you don't need to prune it, don't prune it. And it's going to also give you some really nice fall color and pretty spring flowers as well. I want to touch on another one for the shadier parts of your landscape. This one is Oregon grape holly. This one in particular is aquifolium. It's more of a larger shrub, but there's another one that's more of a ground cover, which is repens, R-E-P-E-N-S. There's some debate going on the name of this. I think it's getting moved over into a new category. So it may change from Mahonia to Berberis, but I don't know if that's happened yet. We'll see. But this is one of the few evergreens that we can grow that will tolerate that shade here in Colorado. if you're from the East Coast and you're used to seeing holly trees, this has a really similar look to a holly tree, except for the flowers and the berries are a little different. Yellow flowers and blue colored berries. So a really nice three-season plant, kind of like Alison mentioned earlier with the serviceberry. Just a really great one. And this one's gonna, again, do well in that shade for you. I also want to mention junipers. I know junipers have, we've been using junipers for a long time. They may be a little overused in certain cases, but they really do well in our landscape. They're very hardy. They're very versatile. You can get these in lots of different shapes, forms, sizes, growth habits, colors. So moving from left to right, we have the Woodward columnar juniper on the far left, a Wichita blue juniper in the second picture there. I think the third one is buffalo, I'm not quite sure. And then some sort of a creeping juniper there off to the far right. But the range here is really great. Very drought tolerant, lots of varieties for you to choose from, and evergreen. So they're gonna keep that green color year round. Other shrubs that then you can try for your dry sites, things like blue mist spirea, boulder raspberry, and butterfly bush, those all have nice flowering characteristics to them. I've got a picture here of the Carol Mackey Daphne. This one is a great option for low water landscapes. It's a little tough to establish, so you gotta give it a little extra care, make sure you give it the right site. Common lilac is one, I wish we had time to cover all these shrubs, we just don't. But common lilac is one that you can put into a low water landscape. It should do pretty well. A lot of the homesteaders brought lilacs out when they came. And so there are lilac plantings around that are quite old and doing just fine with all of that they've had to endure in Colorado. Currants, desert holly, those are a couple other options. The Japanese barberry could be one. It does have thorns, so just keep that in mind. Little leaf mock orange, mountain lover, that's a nice evergreen, almost a ground cover. And then we have mugo pine, privet, nine bark, New Mexico privet, I should say, nine bark, potentilla, red twig dogwood, rock spirea. The snowberry is in the lower right there. That's a nice one with very interesting berries to it, really pretty leaf on it. Skunkbush sumac and yucca. And this is not even the full list. There are still so many that you can incorporate into these drier sites. So Allison's gonna come back on. We're gonna move on into some sun-loving perennials and we'll go from there.
Thank you, Amy. So sun perennials, these are the ones for the really hot, dry parts of your landscape. So we're talking full sun, probably a minimum of 8 hours a day, maybe 6 hours a day, and then all the way into like a southern exposure where they are getting blasted by the sun on a regular basis. So the first one we'll talk about, and we actually, what we consider to be like the three biggies, or the three first ones I'll talk about, is penstemon. This is also known as beard tongue, and what's incredible about penstemon is the diversity, both in the flower look and also the colors. So the four we have listed here from left to right are Grand Mesa, then we have Pike's Peak, and you can see the little butts of those bees sticking out. This is an amazing pollinator plant. All of these are going to attract pollinators, which is incredible. Firecracker is the red one, and then Carolyn's Hope, which is one of my favorites. So it was introduced by the Plant Select Program, and it was for one of the breeders' wives who was diagnosed with breast cancer. So a portion of this plant's proceeds do support the breast cancer research and science that is going on, but it's also that perfectly pink flower. It's just absolutely beautiful. So penstemons are one that if you're not growing them, I would strongly encourage you to consider. The height ranges from 1 to 3 feet tall, and there are a bunch of varieties. So this is where homework for you is key. Your local garden centers might sell many of them. Some of them may not be hardy, especially if you're doing mail order or ordering seeds or things like that. So lots of different varieties out there. About 60 or so are actually native to Colorado. So if you do hike in the forest and the mountains, you'll probably run into penstemon. Bloom time ranges from anywhere from late spring to early summer. They usually have several weeks of bloom on there. Hummingbirds love it, bees love it, and they do tend to be deer resistant. I have rabbits, I bet most of you do, and I haven't noticed that these are being chewed by rabbits, so I would throw rabbits in there as well. The thing with penstemon is they really don't care for really heavy soils, so do try to put them in an area that does have better drainage, but they don't need fertilizer, they don't need a lot of supplemental water. Once established, again, we have to say every plant needs regular water until they are established. Can't hit that home enough. And again, full sun. The next one we'll talk about is salvia. And just in terms of floriferous bloom, salvias are at the top of the list. So let's learn a little bit more about the salvias. These are considered to be the ornamental sages. So while we eat sage, right, we have that with our turkey or other things, it's a big genus. And so there are ornamental types, and there are also edible types. So just don't go munching on all the salvias because it may not be a good thing. This is in the mint family, which may send a chill down your spine because we know that anything in the mint family can be aggressive and spread. The good thing about this is because we're going to likely keep them on the drier side, right? These are hot, dry, drought tolerant perennials. You're not going to have that issue. And actually, if you overwater salvia, they can rot out and get kind of dead in the middle. So definitely once established, start to wean off the water and keep them on the drier side. Mixing them with penstemon is an awesome idea. They go naturally well together. They kind of complement their bloom season so that you have a longer period of bloom because the salvias will bloom later into the summer. And again, the diversity in the flower color, the look are numerous with salvia. It's great. Very tolerant to a wide variety of soils. So if you're battling more of a heavy clay or maybe a new landscape, it's going to work for you. Very pollinator friendly. And the three we have pictured here, so we have Windwalker Royal Red, that's a plant select introduction. And you can see that unique flower. So it's very different than its friend to the right, which is May Night Salvia. She's been around for a very long time. She was a perennial plant of the year a number of years ago and really does well, lots of blooms. What's cool about May Night Salvia is once she blooms for the first time, you can cut her back by about half and you'll get a second set of blooms, but not as much. And then in the lower bottom, we have the silver sage. The leaves, which you can barely see because we have so many white flowers, they're really large, they're fuzzy. This is a plant that gives you texture in the garden. So the flowers are just an added bonus, but the leaves themselves are really, really attractive. Our next perennial is hyssop, also known as agastache. That's how I pronounce it. These are fragrant in the landscape, which is really nice. So they smell a little bit like minty bubblegum. Some of them might smell like anise, that licorice flavor. Another one that is going to be super pollinator friendly with a huge diversity of flower colors that you have. So those three, the salvia, the hyssop, and the penstemon, are three that I think every garden should include in some way, shape, or form. Once established, you only need to water them rarely. And I have found that a couple of them gently reseed. So I have planted some hyssops, I let them complete their flower cycle, and then I find little baby hyssops the next year. They're not by any stretch of the imagination invasive, okay? Very easily controlled. So if they get out of where you want them, you can just remove them. Once the new growth emerges, this is really pretty true for all three of these plants. Once you start to see green at the base, you can cut back all of that, and then that will be what blooms the following or that season. The ones featured here, we have Sonoran Sunset, we have the blue hyssop, so that kind of bluish purple color, again, super pollinator friendly, and the fragrance is nice. Coneflower is one I think we're all familiar with, the echinacea. What's neat about coneflower is that we have a lot of breeding going into echinacea to make them just a little bit more interesting than the traditional lilac-y purple. Not that there's anything wrong with the old standard. Named appropriately because echinacea is Greek for hedgehog, and you can see how it got that name from kind of the center portion of the flower. This is a full sun plant. What you might find that happens is that echinacea does tend to reseed, and it can escape to areas of the landscape where you may not want it, or that could be a welcome addition. Just depends on what you want. I do recommend leaving the seed heads into the winter, fall and winter, just because it provides some interest. It provides a food source for some of the birds and other creatures, but very pollinator friendly. And a couple of cultivars for you to consider. These were all in the CSU perennial trials the last few years, and they have done exceedingly well. So again, what's great about echinacea is they have a really long, several weeks of bloom. They're a great cut flower. You can see how the flowers sit above the foliage, so you really get an impactful show. But there is a series called Kismet. That's that top left picture. So Kismet, there's a raspberry, there's a couple different ones. On the lower bottom, that's Sombrero Trace Amigos. And you can see that there's actually three different colors in there. So there's more of a magenta, there's a raspberry color, there's one that's a little bit darker. So just you get all the colors in one plant, which is great. And if you want something more cottage garden, you might go with Cheyenne Spirit, which again is going to have a mixture of colors with the yellows and the oranges and that kind of traditional lavender color. So cone flowers, look at them. There's more than just the standard purple. Hot flower oregano is one that's technically a ground cover. This is kind of a little guy. It might get about 18 inches tall, but this is grown because of the flowers. And so there's a bract, which you can see it's kind of that purpley green color. And then the flowers are those teeny tiny little purple guys. What's cool about hot flower oregano, this was a plant select introduction, I think back in maybe 2004. And it's great for cut flowers. It's pollinator friendly. It looks phenomenal in a rock garden or a crevice garden, or if you can position it over a retaining wall. And those bracts dry down and turn brown and look really great in the winter as well. Then in the spring, just cut it back when you start to see growth. It's just phenomenal. The next picture just shows off how cool this is. Again, it's more of a ground cover plant. It's not going to be 3 feet tall, but where it kind of fills in gaps in the garden, you can definitely use this. Hot full sun, pollinators love it. Doesn't seem to be a rabbit problem, so consider the hot flower. And lavender, which of course I have featured behind me, lavender is an incredible plant for Colorado. It's really versatile. So obviously, lavender can be used for many reasons. It can be for edibles, like if you're using it in baked goods. We use it a lot, of course, in beauty products like soaps and shampoos. And then it's just so attractive. This is absolutely beautiful. I love it. Maybe you've made the mistake of planting Russian sage. I have. We all have made that mistake. Lavender could be a good substitute if you're ever able to fully remove Russian sage from your garden. This is an herb that thrives in our alkaline soils. So our soil type does not affect this plant. It can take more heavy soils. And Colorado just seems to be a great place to grow lavender. It is winter hardy, has great blooms. What I would recommend is that you plant this in the spring. We found that fall planted lavender may not do as well. It needs just a little bit more time to get established and reestablish its root system. So I would say if you plan on adding lavender, do it this spring or early in the summer. Give it some water to get established and then go from there. And there is one that is so cute. It is called We One. This is a plant select introduction and it's only about 12 inches tall. So if you're planting the traditional English types, they're going to be maybe in bloom about 16, 18 inches tall, maybe 20 inches with the flowers, but We One is just so cute in the little rock garden crevices. Oh, she's adorable. Plant We One, you can see one of the penstemons tucked behind her shoulder there. Sedums and the stone crops, all of the succulents. So I'm going to cover the sedums and then I'll talk about one succulent. These are amazing plants, right? They have adapted to hot, dry conditions. They have the ability to store water, to get through those really tough periods. They're great for rock gardens. They're great for hypertufas. They're great just in the landscape. I love sedums, and one might say I'm obsessed. It's true. Every time I see a sedum in a garden center, I cannot pass it up. So I purchase it and then tuck it in. They can tolerate the poor rocky soils, but they can also do well in the typical clay too. A lot of them are ground covers. We have a couple that are more ornamentals that get to be about knee high. The ground cover types have flowers that I don't love. Love them, but they are cute. I just like the foliage because they're so unique. You can see this diversity of the foliage where we have ones that are maybe a little more cupped, and then we have that some that look more like rosettes. And the flowers do attract bees if you want to keep them. So a couple of different cultivars that you can consider. Winter Fire is my new obsession. This is what it looks like in the winter months. So it's green, like a dark green, like a CSU green during the summer, and then it gets this beautiful red fall color. Who would ever think that would happen with a sedum? Turquoise tails is another plant select introduction. Again, the flowers, you may love them, you may not like them. Planted with the agave in the background, hello, it's amazing. But turquoise tails is more of a, let's say like kind of a clumpy, very unique structure. Autumn Joy is one of the ones that gets to be about knee tall. And what's great about Autumn Joy is it blooms later on into the fall. So this is one that blooms in August or September. Great pollinator plant because at that point we may not have a lot of flowers left in our garden. Those flower heads are huge and heavy. They're almost like cabbages sitting on top of a plant. And they do persist into the winter months, which is wonderful. So you get that really nice winter structure. And then Angelina, you've probably heard of during the summer, she is a bright lime green. And then in the fall and winter, she gets these russets and oranges and just phenomenal. Angelina, Winter Fire together, I think it'd be an incredible duo. So anywhere, a couple of sedums for you to consider. And then I do want to call attention to the hens and chicks, because if you want to start collecting something, maybe this is the collection for you. At least it is for me. There is a bunch of hen and chicks that have been introduced under the name Chick Charms. And there's a ton of diversity to them. You can just see the kind of diversity. So different variegation, different looks. They have super fun names like Mint Marvel and Appletini. There's one called like Cherry Cordial. They are great. They are commonly found in the garden center. You can find the sedums or the hens and chicks there. They have the typical hens and chicks, but maybe add some of these just for a little bit of diversity. And then I will wrap up with just a couple of grasses and some other suggestions of plants. Blonde Ambition Blue Grandma is a great grass, 36 inches tall. This is a native, a selected native. Does great in unirrigated areas, but cannot tolerate the shade. This has been planted everywhere. You will run into this in your travels among the Front Range and beyond. Really hardy up to 9,500 feet as well. And then the next grass is switchgrass. This is Panicum. Great grasses, lots of different cultivars like Heavy Metal and Shenandoah, which is in the lower right. Northwind was introduced by the University of Minnesota. Nice narrow form, very respectful, does not spread, which is good. And then the flowers look like fireworks dancing or cotton candy being spun above those grasses. About 5 feet tall though, so do make sure that you have adequate room for this one. And a few more grasses for sun areas. Amy will cover those in shade. Blue oak grass, little blue stem, that's another native. So there's big blue stem, little blue stem. They do get some nice fall color, which you can see there. Prairie drop seed, kind of a mop top, really, really cool. And then Indian grass. So these are all full sun grasses. We have a great fact sheet on ornamental grasses that John, Darren, or Lisa could pop into the chat for you. So do check those out and then select one that works best for your conditions.
All right. Great, Alison. Thanks for the sun-loving perennials. Let's talk a little bit about some shade-loving perennials. So dry shade is one of those areas that it's a niche, and it's hard to sometimes think of plants that you can put into a dry shade situation. Let's start out with Denver Gold Columbine. I love this plant. I love columbine in general. You know, it is our state flower. This yellow form, though, called Denver Gold, one thing that makes it different from the normal Rocky Mountain columbine is that it blooms almost the whole summer, from June through September, much longer than your blues and your reds. You can also cut those blooms back periodically. That can help encourage new blooms. It is a native to the Southwest. It is a plant selection. Just a really nice, good way to have some pop of color, some brightness in those shady areas. You know, when you look at that lower picture there, your eye is drawn toward those yellow flowers, and it really makes you not want to look back at that dark understory shade area. It just gives it that bright pop that the area needs. Another columbine that you could use, this is another plant select variety, is Swan Violet and White, or called Remembrance. This one is much better in the part shade. The Denver Gold can actually go either way, sun or shade. This one likes to have a little bit more shade than that. Not quite as tall, but man, those flowers are striking. They have that really deep, dark purple toward the back on the bracts, and then those white petals and that yellow center just really showing off very well. These will benefit from a little bit of moisture, but one thing to think about with shade is that you're going to get that moisture retention just for the fact that you're in the shade. So, but giving these just a little bit of irrigation can help give them a bigger and better display, but they will also do okay with a lack of water too. Johnson's Blue Cranesbill. This is kind of a one-off plant. This one here that we want to mention, really great plant, full sun to full shade. So a big range again here in where it can grow, and it can fit that niche. It's going to also bloom late spring and then last all the way up into early fall. So giving you that full season of color, beautiful little periwinkle blue flowers. The leaves are very attractive with their finely cut pattern to them. It does get a little bit of fall color. This one does like that sandy soil or just a more normal soil. But, you know, I've seen this one grown in so many different locations, and it seems to be very well adapted. So Johnson's Blue, this is a perennial geranium. It's not the typical annual geraniums that you're buying, you know, to put into your hanging baskets. This is a perennial type. So Johnson's Blue, give that one a try. One of my favorites for the dry shade garden is coral bells. And as you can see, the variety of options here, there's just so many. So sun to full shade again, really they like that shade more so. You'll get a more vibrant color in the shade, especially with some of these lime and yellow types. Very attractive leaves. There's been a lot of breeding going on with these type of plants. There's a nursery on the West Coast called Terra Nova. I had I was just so lucky to get to go visit it. And the plants that they're creating there, it's like they can come up with another one, and then there's another one. Some of these have variegated leaves. Some are dark purple. Some are pink. Some are green. There's so many things you could do. You could have a whole section with just coral bells and really make it look really kind of cool. Let's see. So you can cut those flowers off. They do sit above the foliage, maybe up to 18 inches. You can cut those off periodically. That can help extend that bloom time. But like some of the other plants Alison mentioned, these are really grown more for the foliage. One of my favorites is the one up here in the upper left. That's Snow Angels. Coral bells. Palace purple is the one off to the right here. And then just again, so many others. Here's some of those options for you. There's that snow angel again. Palace purple is a very popular one. And then there's this carnival series with these really nice leaves with kind of this mottled look to them, and lime marmalade. Again, if you want to add that brightness into your shade, choose these yellows and lime greens to do that. Siberian bug loss or Brunnera is another option. Now there is a Brunnera that's a little bit more invasive. This is a different kind. It's a Siberian bug loss, particularly this one called Jack Frost. And these are great. These will do great in part to full shade. They'll be more of like a ground cover, like a large leaf ground cover if you plant them in mass. Little tiny blue flowers that are just so delicate and dainty, and they come in the spring and you just love them. But then once those flowers kind of fade, you've got that beautiful variegated foliage behind it to carry you through the rest of the season with some interest. Very hardy here. Again, Jack Frost is the one up here in the top. And then Alexander's Great was a winner of the CSU trials that have much bigger leaves. Lady's Mantle, another one for the dry shade garden. This one has nice, big, large, fuzzy leaves. And if you do water or we get a little bit of rain, the water droplets sit on the top of those leaves and they shine and they become a little bit iridescent. And it's just really a cool thing to see. Little tiny little chartreuse flowers sitting above that, not too noticeable. Those will happen in the early summer, but this is just a really nice, can handle that full shade, can handle those drought conditions. Lady's Mantle is definitely one to try. And then one of my favorites is hardy plumbago or leadwort. I have this one growing at my house and it loves the shade. It's a nice little plant. Green leaves, bright blue flowers. It will hold its blooms all through the summer into the fall. And then you get this pop of red color at the end of the season. And that red against that blue, it just really stands out. This one can also be grown as a ground cover. It likes our soils. It likes any kind of soils, really pretty adaptable and pretty low water once you get this one established. Like some of the ones Alison mentioned, plant this in the spring, like you do your lavender. It's going to help it establish that root system better. And then finally, just a few grasses for your dry shade areas. Blue fescues can handle partial shade. That's the picture up here in the upper left. Blue oat is kind of a bigger version of the blue fescue, a little bigger there. Korean feather reed grass, you can get that one. It'll do great in partial shade. The little blue stem Alison mentioned will do good in the sun. It will also take some light shade. We have overdam reed grass here on my lower left. That's a variegated form of our friend Carl Forrester. So if you have Carl Forrester reed grass, you'll see it everywhere. It's green on the bottom and kind of a straw color on the top where the seed heads are. And it's just a lot overplanted. And so the overdam could be a nice option to replace the Carl Forrester. And the variegation will show up better in the shade. The shade kind of brightens those colors, more saturation to those colors. And then the lower right there, again, prairie drop seed. So good for the sun, but can also handle that light shade as well. So we're gonna wrap it up with our last couple minutes. We just wanna remind you about right plant, right place, and what does it really mean? It means using that space, finding the purpose of that space, choosing the right plants, and then placing them where they want to be. Instead of modifying your landscape, let's just modify our plant palette and work with our gardens instead of against them, making sure that they have the growing conditions that they need. Again, I just want to mention that we've got several resources out there. Go visit those public gardens. We've shown you a few pictures today where you can go and see those. You can also find on Plant Select's website, they have a list of Plant Select gardens around the state. Most Plant Select plants are going to be low water, highly adapted. And so you can find out where there is a Plant Select Xeric garden near you and then go visit. Tons of stuff from CSU. Check out our blog. I'm going to bring Alison back on and our panel. Do we have any last minute things we need to cover or questions that are still hanging out there?
I just want to remind people that this was recorded. If you're on this webinar, you've registered and you'll get the recording within a week or so.
Hey, Amy, since you're the dry shade person, we did have one just come in. And yeah. About a shady spot that the only sun it gets is in the afternoon when it's that blazing western sun. Any thoughts about your favorite plants for that sort of situation?
Yeah. In fact, some of the ones that are sun loving will actually do probably better than a shade loving plant in that situation. I have grown on my west facing, the penstemons are going to love that hot, hot afternoon sun, and they can actually handle just a little bit of that morning shade just fine. So you could try penstemons. Some of the bulbs would be great in that situation. But I think in the case of an afternoon sun, that's going to be more impactful than the little bit of shade it gets in the morning. So let's choose more sun-loving plants for those areas.
Thanks, Amy. And then maybe both of you to weigh in on. Deborah would like to know, in terms of watering, do you recommend a drip system or some other kind of sprinkler system? How should we water things when they do need water?
Well, I know what John would recommend. And that would be no irrigation system, which I think
that's why I asked you.
Yes. And I think that's definitely an option. You know, as we've talked about today, you really need to water these the first year to get them established. If you can do that by hand, and you know, you might be watering maybe once a week, maybe a couple times a week that right after planting, but then maybe backing off to once a week and then just kind of tapering it down every couple weeks, you can eventually get to where that landscape will sustain itself. You'll lose some plants along the way. You'll replace them with more drought tolerant plants. And that's how you get to that zero water situation. But you can absolutely do drip on your low water landscape. You just want to make sure it's on its own zone so that you can turn it off when you need to, because you're going to be turning it off more than you're going to be turning it on. Alison, what do you think? Any other tips there?
No, that covered it perfectly.
Yeah. You can also use like a sprinkler, overhead sprinkler type situation. You just don't want to be doing that very often to where it's getting overwatered. So I have seen that too. But always backing off after they get established. All right. I've put Alison and I's contact information on the screen. You can contact us with any additional questions. We will be, you'll be getting a follow-up email tomorrow asking you to fill out our survey, let us know how we're doing, give us those tips of what else you want to learn about. And I suppose we will see you all next week for What's Bugging You with Lisa. So thank you everyone for joining, and we'll take you out with a little bit more of our fun music so we can all keep dancing. Have a good weekend. Hello, fine people.
Oh, hi again.
Nice to see you. Oh, you didn't change. Well, you just, the green, it's just, I'm sorry. It's not doing it for you.
Oh, and I don't have a right plant, right place background.
Darren, come on.
What is
this? Expect more.
WTF. This is what it's going to be.
I need to change mine too.
Is that a hawthorn?
No, it's
that's the Boulder County Garden.
Yeah, it's the honeysuckle, the blue velvet.
That's enormous.
It is. It's actually like one of the holy cow ones around. I believe Carrie Badisher planted it. Were you around during her time, Alison?
Yeah. Oh, yes.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, she was a nutter. Holy cow.
Of them in Fuller County.
Yeah. I think she still has an Estes.
Allen's Park.
Okay.
So I think it's up in that direction.
Running a pot business?
Yeah.
Okay, I'm going to go ahead and share my screen. That's not what I want to share. Share. Try this again.
Good tunes. Man, I did a webinar for somebody, I can't remember who recently, and there was no music and it was just all awkward in the beginning.
It's just weird without the music. You got to have the music. It's a whole production.
Listen, baby. Ain't no mountain high. It could be a lot louder.
Okay.
Like, I would say, like, lift the heavy. Call me.
Is that better?
Yeah.
Love the tunes.
It'd
be great.
How have I not used this song before? I'm shocked.
I don't know. It just came to me because I thought, like, there's nowhere we can't plant something. There's a right place for every plant.
I like it.
Good thinking.
I live my life in music in my head. Darren knows this. I'll be like, today's song is this.
And there's always a good, like, justification reason for it. I'm like, yes,
it's just that is green. Do you think I need to put headphones in? Do I sound okay?
Hear you fine.
Okay, good, then I won't.
Yeah,
you sound amazing.
Okay, so Darren, you're going to do introductions. Do you want to welcome everyone to the webinar? And my next slide is the equal opportunity. Or do you want me to do that? And like all of the, we're recording.
Would you like me to? Or does it, I mean,
I have a little list that I keep.
Feel like, should you guys just do it since you do it every week?
We could. It's fine.
I can introduce you, Amy, and you introduce me.
Yeah, we can do it all. Do you want us to just do it?
It's not that I don't want to. I could, but you guys just have been doing this every week and you have your little list and
okay.
I could say welcome to the webinar today. Our presenters are Amy Lentz and Alison O'Connor and they're super awesome and they're gonna get us started. Here we go.
Why don't I do this? Why don't I welcome people, do this little ditty about equal opportunity access, non-discrimination, closed captioning, recording, put your questions in the Q&A. I'll turn it over to Darren. I'll tell him, you know, we got a few more of these coming up. And then I'll turn it over to you, Darren, when I put this title slide up.
Okay, and I'll say now.
And you could introduce us.
Put your hands together for.
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah. You just heard from Amy, but I'd like to introduce her as.
Sure.
One of the speakers today.
And then we'll just cover it.
Okay.
I love the lavender.
I like the hype. The hype.
Yeah. It's a production. It's a thing. Okay. And then we'll roll right into our presentation. So cool. Let me see how many we have registered. We did not have that many registered. I was kind of shocked.
I saw it advertised.
I did too. On Facebook or Instagram, people are picking it up.
Mm-hmm. Well, maybe we got a few more. Let's see.
360?
Hi, Lisa. I didn't say hi.
Looks like we have 360.
That's pretty good.
Just not here. It's like you hit that thousand mark one time and you expect it every time.
You want it.
You know, though, we should check after, because it seems like there's always a whole bunch of people who do register because they just can't commit. You know?
Like they'll just register as they join. Yeah.
So we should look to see what the total attendees are. It's always like 50 more, I think, I feel.
Yeah. I'm just going to keep that screen share going. And then can somebody do a backup recording?
Yeah, I can do that.
I'm recording.
Are you recording now?
I think it started recording when I turned it on.
Oh, it probably did. I have it set to automatically record on a local computer so that we never forget.
So Amy's recording, I'm recording. Lisa, you're going to record?
Sure.
A lot of records. Hey, Mergel. Hey, John.
I'm also recording. Yeah, we're all recording. Everyone's recording. It's John here. John's here.
John, hit record.
I don't know why I'm not actually appearing.
I know. Because you have a little bar at the top of your screen up here. Just slide it.
I don't, though. I have an independent webcam.
Oh, weird.
I like that you're just a field. Working. You're amazing.
Are you close enough? Yeah.
I'm sitting where I normally sit. I'm going to see. I may be. I mean, not that it really matters that I'm invisible.
It is, for some reason, extra funny that there's a voice coming from a field.
It's like
is he behind a tree? Where is he?
Honey, I shrunk the kids.
Oh, there you go.
There you are.
Phew.
Oh, I'm tired.
Here we go.
Are we all excited about some right plant, right place?
We hope so.
Boy, howdy.
I mean, I'm more excited about Marvin Gaye personally, but yes.
So explain the connection with the
it's song. Good.
So there's a right plant, a right place for every plant. No mountain high enough, no valley low enough, no river wide. We can find a place.
Find a plant for you. Okay.
Yes. Okay. We're gonna connect those together. Keep me from getting, nothing can keep you from getting a plant that will work for
you. Or it's just a really good song, John.
Just really good.
It's just a really good song.
I'm just gonna like all the songs. Why did we pick this one?
I don't know. Why did we pick water music last week by?
It was about watering.
Did they have irrigation systems at the time?
No, and that was the point of my talk. Irrigation system is a thing that people did not garden with.
Was it? Is it Handel? What? How do you say that guy's name?
Handel works. Yeah.
Handel. 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 I don't know. I asked the same thing. I was like, "How do I pronounce this?" And I realized I won't even be saying this. So,
yeah,
it's fine.
It was Handel before he moved to England, but he moved to England and decided he was English, so he changed his name from Georg to George. Started saying Handel, so it's
how you know all this stuff, John.
No, you gotta be a nerd about some things. I don't know anything about Marvin Gaye, if that is helpful.
I'm gonna run grab a tissue real quick. I'll be right back.
I'm gonna close my office.
You guys have good notebook organization. Like, you have certain projects that gets it, if it's big enough, it gets its own notebook, or do you just put like everything in a single notebook?
Ladder.
Everything in a single. Me too. So I have a bajillion of these that are full, and I can go back and find notes from a meeting or whatever, but I feel like there's a more efficient way to do it.
Oh, I'm 100% sure there is. I just.
Okay. Well, I thought this group might have that way figured out. So thought I'd ask.
I have notes everywhere. And then in my notebook that I take notes in, I've got probably 20 sticky notes. Of different things, and I don't know. I have not figured that out. But it works. I know where everything is. It just looks like chaos.
Yeah. Well, I'm missing a key notebook right now, and I'm like, where is it? I was asking about notebook organization because I have 8 million of these that are full of notes. Yeah, and I was just wondering if you all had.
So there's a program called OneNote. It should be already on your computer. Do you ever use it?
No, but OneNote is awesome.
It's like a giant trapper keeper, and you can create different tabs. And I use it as just an overall pasting thing. Like if I need to remember something out of an email, I just paste it onto there. I have different sections, like Master Gardener sections and then hort things. Let me show you real quick.
That's a good idea.
Sure. There are these digital notebooks. Like one is called Rocket Notebook. And you write in it with these special pens that you can then erase. And then you like take a picture of it and it turns it into a PDF on the cloud or something.
Our communications person uses that and she loves it. I'm old school.
Ooh, Amy.
You can drop files on this thing. So like this is a PDF file that I dropped on here. And so I just use it to like keep track of stuff. And then once I'm done with it, I just delete it off of here. So it's just literally like a notebook. I have like a shitload of sections too.
Well, that's so organized though.
Yeah, I've never
one note. And it saves automatically. You don't have to save it. It's just saves.
Okay.
It's kind of nice. Especially like when you're coordinating volunteers and you're like, I should tell my volunteers this.
I email myself. And then I have a running list of things. I do that too, Allison.
Yeah. Here I just stick it on here and I'm like, this is all the stuff I need to tell Master Gardeners before the end of the month. And then I'll write up an email. It's just you can try it.
Yeah.
It works. Yeah, that's cool. I find it helpful.
Like an app on your phone? So if you're like somewhere, not at a computer, you can
You probably could.
Okay.
Good. And I think it might even be in SharePoint. It's a Microsoft product.
Okay.
Well, I mean, it's right in the Outlook. I mean, I use Outlook for email. It's right in there.
I've never
used it. Yeah. Allison, good to know that your communications person uses the digital kind of notebook thing.
I know she loves it.
I don't know if I'd
Someone remind me to update the blog. Someone put it in my notes.
Okay.
Oh, just sometime?
Yeah. I'll email myself.
Email yourself.
Update blog.
Okay, before we get too far, I just want to let everybody know that Allison and I have 70 slides to do in 60 minutes. So we probably won't take any questions during. We'll just wait until the end and see if we have time. But it's awesome that we have all of you awesome people in the background.
You're amazing. Thank you.
To answer questions. And I'll make sure to introduce you guys too.
Okay.
John, I have a piano lesson today and my teacher was sick for 4 weeks. I didn't touch the ivories in those 4 weeks.
Oh, good luck at your lesson.
Thanks. It's going to be a disaster. I'm like, where is the C chord?
You're going to be great. You're going to be so
fun. No. Fortunately, she's like 78 and she's kind of like, it's obviously the tail end of her career. So she doesn't care.
You've seen this sort of behavior before, Alice.
After me is a little five-year-old, so I've got to be better than Charlie. Come on.
You're different than Charlie. You want to put value judgments on any of this.
Charlie can't even reach the pedals.
Yeah.
What a loser. Kidding.
Stupid kid.
John, are your kids in music lessons?
Not yet.
Silas is though,
really,
right?
Wants to learn the trombone. And I told her she had to start with the piano. And then she said she doesn't want to learn the trombone anymore because she's so opposed to learning the piano. I think she's just nervous about it. I told her if it helps, think that you're going to learn music at the piano. You're not learning how to play the piano. You're just learning about music.
You didn't say something like, my parents forced me and I'm going to force you.
No, I mean, no, it's just, it's going to be so much easier to think about than just starting with a thing with a slide.
Trombone, yeah, holy moly,
that's hard.
I don't know why she decided she wants to play trombone. I have no idea. She just decided she wanted to play trombone. All right. That's fine.
All right.
Yeah, I know.
All right, 11:59. So, Amy, you're opening it and doing the front slides, and then I'm introducing you guys.
Yeah, what I'll do is I'll talk about future classes, and then I'll introduce the panel and throw it to you.
Okay.
And okay. Then if you guys, if we mention a link or something, if one of you could put that in the chat. Thank you.
Okay, so camera's off. And we will start the video, the show. Welcome everyone to our webinar today. We're so glad you could join us. Let me go ahead and get started with a few housekeeping items. We are offering closed captioning for this webinar. If you need that, you can do that through the controls on your screen through Zoom. We are also an equal opportunity access and non-discrimination university at Colorado State. And if you want to learn more about our principles of community or our land acknowledgement statement, or if we can provide services to you, just reach out to us or visit our website at colostate.edu. We will be recording today's class. It'll take us about a week to get that recording posted. It will go up on our cohorts blog, where you also the same place where you registered for this class. As we go along today, there probably will be some questions. And so just please put those into the Q&A section. And we will be probably closing the chat down. So just put those in the Q&A. And let me go ahead and skip to our next slide and let you know that we do have still some more classes coming up. Next week, we'll be doing beetles bugging you. We have edible landscaping at the end of the month. And then the first week of May, we'll do all about trees. Let me go ahead and introduce our panel for you. We have Lisa Mason. She is our horticultural specialist in Arapahoe County. She'll be teaching you next week, right, with beetles bugging you. We have John Mergel. You heard from him last week on the proven xeriscape practices. He's our hort specialist down in Douglas County. And then we have Darren Davidson, our statewide sustainable landscaping specialist with us today. And she's going to help us out too. All of them will be working on that Q&A, a very expert panel for you to ask your questions to. I'm going to turn it over to Darren. She's going to do some introductions and then we'll get started.
Thanks, Amy. Hi, everybody. Thanks for joining us. So the webinar today is a very timely topic. Lots and lots of interest about this. Right plant, right place for low water landscapes. And today we have the privilege of hearing from a very dynamic duo, Amy Lentz and Alison O'Connor. You already saw their chair dancing skills, but just wait until you hear what they have to present. Alison is our Larimer County horticulture specialist, and Amy Lentz is in Weld County. And ladies, can't wait to hear what you have to say. Take it away.
All right. Thanks, Darren. Okay. So let's talk about right plant, right place. And we're going to focus today solely on those low water landscapes. So let's start out by just kind of going over some background information. about the place that we live and what we're dealing with here. So here in Colorado, as you all probably know, we are a semi-arid state. We also have a lot of variation across the state in our climate. So whether you're in the mountains or on the eastern plains or out west, things are going to be a little bit different in each of those locations. There's also going to be variation maybe even within your own landscape with microclimates. We also have this pressure of increasing growth in Colorado. People love it here. They're coming out. And what that's going to do is it's going to put more and more demand on our water supply. Our governments are starting to look into this. Our cities and towns are starting to pay more attention. It's just becoming, as Darren mentioned, a really hot topic. And what we want to talk to you today about is choosing those right plants for those right places so that you can create an outdoor landscape that uses much less water, in some cases 60% or even more. You can have a fully unirrigated landscape with the right plant choices and helping them get established that first year. Just to give you an idea of some of this variability across the state, if you're in Gunnison or Pueblo, you guys are getting less than 13 inches of rain a year, or precipitation, I should say. This includes rain and snow. Colorado Springs, about 17 and a half inches of precip a year. Durango and Boulder and Steamboat, you guys are getting a little bit more. Steamboat, almost to 24 inches, but that's still not a lot. So over in the East Coast, they're getting upwards of 35 to 40 inches of rain a year or precipitation a year. So when we're thinking about all these factors that we have to deal with, it's really great for us to think about considering plants that are adapted to our climate and adapted to these low water requirements. Instead of changing your landscape, let's change our plant palette to fit the landscape. John talked about this a lot last week, had some really great tips. And so today we're going to build on that and focus in on choosing those appropriate plants to reduce those water needs. And in turn, you're going to reduce the need for fertilizers and pesticides and things that you have to add for plants that aren't well adapted. So what does this right plant, right place really mean? There's a lot of things to think about, but the three main things are the purpose of the space. Is it fitting within that purpose that you're looking for? Is it the right plant? And then is it placed in the right spot? And then is it gonna have the right growing conditions to thrive? And so as you can see in this picture, beautiful, this is a crepe myrtle. This is obviously somewhere in the South, beautiful tree, bush, whatever you wanna call it, but this is not the right place for that plant. It is not fulfilling that purpose of space that it should be. If they wanted shade from this, it's not happening. It's right up against the house. So the second point there, plant selection and placement. This is not the right plant for this place either. I apologize that this picture is a little grainy, but what you can see here is a tree that was much too big for this space that would have gone into the power lines was chosen for this area. And so then they have to change their management to now make this plant fit within the landscape. So again, we're going to try to do something a little different. Growing conditions. Should this plant be growing in this small of a space between a very narrow space between a sidewalk and a street? Probably not the right growing conditions for a tree. And in some cases, maybe you shouldn't have plants there at all. Is it something that can even support plant life? And so in this picture here, you can see this flooded out corner of the yard. I think there are bigger problems here than choosing the right plant. In this situation, there might be a hardscaping option that would be a better thing here. So pulling all this together, looking at that, all those factors, we want to look for height and width, mature size of these plants, making sure that we give them enough space when we plant them. Thinking about the growth habit of those, are they going to have enough room above them to make it, to give them what they need? And then you might also consider things like your root system. Is it shallow? Is it wide? Is it going to create surface roots? All of these things can help you choose the right plants for that right place. And this goes for trees and shrubs as well. It's not just your perennials. So we're thinking across our plant palette. When we look at those growing conditions, we're going to think about sun versus shade. Some plants are very intolerant of shade. Some plants are very intolerant of our heat, our high heat and sun intensity here. So getting them sited correctly in that sun and shade environment is important. Our soil conditions, as we mentioned last week, rather than trying to work against our soil, maybe we just want to choose things that are going to do well in clay or do well in sand. Do you have moisture pockets? Is there a certain spot in your yard maybe where you get a little bit more drainage? And so those plants might have just a little bit more water availability than other locations. And then you got to think about things like wind, slope, hardiness zone, and humidity. So we talked about this a little bit last week, and we just want to drive home this point again today. So we're going to be talking a lot about low water plants. These are things that are generally adapted to our native soils. And most of these low water and native plants are not going to want a highly amended soil. In fact, they're going to prefer that unamended soil, that lean soil that's pretty low in organic matter. So skip the compost around some of these, most of these low water and xeric type plants. Hydrozone your plants together, put them in different locations that have different watering requirements. So this is a picture, I think this is in Phoenix. This is a tall fescue irrigated lawn with saguaro cacti in it. The cacti might want 1 or 2 inches of rain, I don't know, every couple months. And then the lawn wants that much water every week. So obviously these two things are competing against each other. These are not the right plants for this place. Consider mulch. That's going to help you out a lot with your low water landscapes. Mulch is going to help with water conservation. It's going to improve the soil. It's going to help protect some of those plant roots that are under the ground, inhibiting weed competition. Please don't use weed fabric around a lot of these plants. It's just going to totally mess up the soil and not be the type of situation that you want. And then all over, if you put this mulch down, you're going to reduce that irrigation need by as much as 50%. Do you use rock mulch? Do you use wood mulch? It really depends on the plant. It depends on your design aesthetic, what you want to do. You could even do a combination of both, like you see in the picture, and then choose the plants to fit into those accordingly. Some plants do prefer that rock mulch. A lot of these low water plants, in fact, like that pea gravel type mulch. And then finally, think about maintenance. A low water landscape is not a no maintenance landscape. There's still going to be a few things that you need to do. The first year is really important with these low water plants. We need to get them established. We need to water them in and water them regularly that first season to help those roots set and get them going. After that, you can start to back off of that water. Depending on the plant, you may never have to water it again. It just depends. Again, on that plant. Using that right mulch, again, will help prune these as you needed, but really these are meant to be a little bit more natural in their shape and form. And then let your plants reseed. Let things go like coneflower or hyssops or sedums, and they'll spread around and they'll find that niche that works for them. And they'll be the right plant for the right place. So we're going to cover a lot of different plants coming up for the rest of the class, but I do want to mention before we get started that there are tons of resources for you out there in terms of choosing the right plants and what's available to you. First, I think the greatest thing you can do is just go visit one of your local public gardens. There are xeric landscaping gardens all across Colorado. They're going to have plants that work here in your local area. They're going to have signage to help you identify those plants. And it's just a really great way to see what it actually looks like in the garden setting, as opposed to in a pot at the nursery. But local nurseries are also a really great resource. Our CSU Extension website has tons of fact sheets and plant talk articles, videos. We have garden notes, and we also have our cohorts blog, tons of videos there as well. Look at things like the Front Range tree recommendation list. Look to Plant Select. We'll be covering Plant Select a lot in today's class, a lot of the plants that they offer. And then things like Colorado Native Plant Society, High Plains Environmental Center, and Resource Central. All of these places and these resources are out there for you to help you make your choices. So I'm going to turn it over to Alison, and she's going to get us started with some of the plants that you can grow in your low water landscape.
All right, thanks, Amy. Hey, everybody. It's good to have you with us on this Friday. And so we are going to really hit home these four big topics. Amy and I really struggled to get it down to a reasonable level of plants that we could actually teach in an hour. So trees, shrubs, perennials, and ornamental grasses. We aren't able to talk about tulips and our spring bulbs, but you should know that a lot of the spring blooming bulbs are very low water. We plant them in the fall, we'll water them a few times, but then they're using winter's moisture to actually bloom the following spring. So bulbs like these species tulips can be really drought tolerant. But next slide, we're going to start things off with trees. And so the first tree that we're going to talk about is coming up because I do want to tell you that trees are amazing. So we are in the middle of Arbor Day month. Next week is Colorado Arbor Day. The following Friday is National Arbor Day. And with trees, it's interesting because there are some amazing trees that can tolerate dry conditions, drought, and that's what we'll cover today. A good thing to keep in mind is that if you are planning to convert your landscape, maybe removing turf, maybe reducing water use, what you currently have planted, especially your trees, needs to be considered. The photo below is actually a green ash tree. So the one on the left is right after the turf adjacent to the tree was removed. And then the second picture is that tree a few years later. You can start to see some dieback happening. So if you make these radical changes or even minor changes, keep in mind what's existing there, because we don't want to lose a 20-year-old tree. We don't want to have to replace something and have to wait for that shade. So consider trees to be a very big investment. Next slide. So bur oak is our first one. I love the oaks, and it's hard to pick just one to talk about. Bur oak is great. We see it a lot on the eastern plains going into Nebraska, and it is considered to be a native tree species. For a lot of our urban landscapes, some of the bur oaks are going to get too big, but there's a lot of different variation in their sizes because for the most part, oaks are still propagated from seed. So if you've seen Ansel Adams, you've seen the big behemoth bur oaks, they can get very, very large. They have incredible acorns. Their fall color is maybe yellowish at best, but their acorns are almost completely covered by those fringe of scales. So bur oaks are a really wonderful tree to consider, very large shade tree. Next slide. The next tree is one that Amy is intimately familiar with because she grew up in Cincinnati, Kentucky, Cincinnati/Kentucky on the border. Gymnocladus dioicus is the Kentucky coffee tree. This is one that is absolutely incredible, but I do want to point out that on the far right in the middle slide, that is what it looks like when you're going to be purchasing it from a garden center. There's not a lot to it, but if you give it 5 to 7 to 9 years, it's going to develop into this incredible tree that you then see in the other pictures. So a really nice spreading crown. I feel it has interesting fruits, which are depicted in the far bottom right. And there are podless types available. They have super cute names like espresso and decaf. There is one that's been introduced that's better for smaller columnar spaces called skinny latte. But Kentucky coffee tree as a whole, very adaptable, drought tolerant, huge leaves, yellow fall color. It really checks most of the boxes as a great tree for our landscapes. A smaller tree to consider is the golden rain tree. Golden rain is phenomenal because it blooms in July. So we're talking a little bit later into the summer when it puts on a show. And when it's in bloom, it is absolutely covered in these bright yellow flowers. And then as they start to fade and shatter, they kind of trickle down to the ground, which is why it's called golden rain, because it really does seem like it's raining golden petals. The fruits then form, and they almost look like lanterns or pods. They persist well into the fall and usually into the winter months. Again, fruits, acorns, pods, all of that is very subjective. So what I love, you may not dig, and we get that, but this is definitely a three-season tree. The one complaint I hear is that it might be a little weak wooded, so we might see some damage from heavy wet snows or winds, so good pruning is recommended for golden rain. The next one on the list is Tatarian maple. I'm sure most of you have heard of the cultivar, the introduction Hot Wings. It is a plant select introduction, one of the first plants that was introduced by the plant select program from Scott Skogerbo, who is the gentleman in the middle of the photo there. He's a propagator at Fort Collins Wholesale Nursery. And the Tatarian maple is a great tree. Now, it does prefer drier sites. If it's planted in wet feet or where maybe there's a little bit too much moisture, it is not going to perform. This tree was selected, the hot wing specifically, was selected because the fruits are the Samaras, the helicopter guys. They are a bright cherry red in the summer. So you have this, and you can see this in the photos, of these bright cherry red Samaras contrasting with the dark green leaves. This is definitely a smaller ornamental, so only about 20 by 20, and it does have a lot of great merits. It can be sold as a single stem, which is in the top right corner, or it can be sold as a clump. So there are some variations for this, but again, site selection, like Amy talked about, is absolutely critical for all of these trees. And I can't emphasize enough to make sure that you have the space to accommodate the tree at full maturity. That's so important. Tatarian maple also tends to get red fall color, which is wonderful. The next one is also a smaller ornamental, a serviceberry, and we do have native serviceberries in Colorado. So the Utahensis is actually one of the native species, but this is a three-season plant. It is phenomenal. Can't say enough good things. So in the spring, it has these beautiful white blossoms that actually cover the tree or a large shrub, however you want to look at it, in its entirety. Those flowers develop into what tastes like blueberries. It's the closest thing that we can have in Colorado to blueberries, but it is unlikely that you will get to taste any because the birds absolutely love them. So it does have an edible fruit that looks a little bit like a blueberry. And then in the fall, there are some introductions like Autumn Brilliance that have been selected for really incredible fall color. So those cherries and those oranges that, if you grew up in the Midwest or another part of the United States on the East Coast, you might miss. We have a lot of amazing yellow fall color in Colorado, but not as much of those reds, those anthocyanins that we so desperately want. So serviceberry is a great tree. Like the hot wings maple or the Tatarian maple we just met, it can be sold as a single stem or a clump. The one in the top picture is more of a clump, and so you can see how it can be a very large shrub. But serviceberry, one of my absolute favorite trees. It's readily available in the nursery trade and just fits such a nice space into the garden. So consider that one. Others that you can consider, that's the whirlwind tour of trees that we just covered, but other trees that you can consider and that are pictured here, the big tooth maple, that is a native species to Colorado. There are some newer cultivars that are coming out. The nice thing is A, it's a maple, which we don't have a lot of maples that we can promote, simply because some of them are finicky with our soils and pH. The big tooth is a great adapted tree. Also beautiful fall color, love that one. Sensation box elder is down in the lower left. That one also gets nice fall color. Don't be scared that I said box elder. It's a male clone, so it doesn't get any sort of samaras that encourage box elder bugs. And then the hawthorn, so Russian hawthorn, thornless cockspur, all of those are great choices. The flowers don't smell great, but they have a lot of really good merits. So I'm going to throw it. Oh, I have one more. Sorry about that. The pinyon pine. So we are going to just mention this as a potential evergreen. This is one site selection is so important because we don't want to put this in an area that gets regular irrigation. This is a native tree to the southwest part of Colorado. It's obviously our source of pine nuts. If you plant one tree, you're not going to make enough to get pesto. I apologize. It takes 2 years to develop those fruits too. So not very productive. But pinyon pine really loves hot, dry, sunny locations. It does not like lawn watering. It does not want to be overwatered. I've seen a lot more pinions killed from too much water than a lack thereof. But the cones are cute. They look like little roses in bloom. So a lot of great things about the pinyon pine. And the needles, when you snap them, almost have like an orangey scent. So consider the pinion. A couple other evergreens, bristlecone, that's also known as the foxtail pine. You can go an elevation up to about 10 to 12,000 feet. So that's another native species. Ponderosa is native, generally gets maybe a little too big for urban areas. Ponderosa, unlike the spruce and the bristlecone pine, tends to shed its lower branches. That's just a natural adaptation to fires. So that's interesting. We would caution you against using the blue spruce and the white fir. The spruce tends to really prefer consistent moisture levels and maybe a little bit higher moisture, the same thing with the fir. So both are native, but they really like to have consistent moisture, not drought tolerant that we have found. So I'll throw it back to Amy.
All right, thanks, Alison. All right, let's shift gears a little bit, moving down in size. We're going to talk about a few shrubs that are going to do really good in these low water landscapes. I do want to mention that low water doesn't necessarily mean no water. You can get to a point with certain plants if you want to do a no water garden. That's great. We're focusing today on things that do need a little, some that do need a little bit of irrigation. So low water for most of these, especially these trees and shrubs, there aren't very, very few that could handle not being irrigated. But we're looking at reducing that irrigation. So let's talk about some shrubs. This slide here. The first one I want to mention is rabbit brush. So if you're from the eastern side of Colorado, especially up here around the northeastern part, you might actually see rabbit brush just growing along the roadsides. It is a great plant for here. It is a native plant to here. And since we've been, you know, growing these, we've come to find a couple of varieties or cultivars that we can use more in a home garden setting. And one of those would be baby blue rabbit brush. It's a plant select plant. It's a dwarf type. It's going to be 2 feet high, maybe 2 feet wide, as opposed to the original rabbit brush that's growing out there in the wild, which is 6 feet high and 6 feet wide. So if you're looking for that smaller native type shrub, this one is a great option. It's got beautiful yellow blooms at the end of the season, and it is a great pollinator plant. We have a couple of these in our demonstration garden at Weld County. They're also behind me in my picture, and they are just covered in pollinators for a lot of the summer. Viburnum is another option that you could use. This one will be good if you have a little bit of shade that you're dealing with, dry shade in particular. There are a lot of different kinds. There's one called Mini Man, a little smaller up in the upper left. The Wayfaring Tree is the upper right corner picture there. And then we also have the Leather Leaf or the Allegheny, which is the lower picture there. The Leather Leaf might need just a little bit more water than the other ones, just because of its size. And it's a little bit more used to the eastern part of the United States. Depending on the type, these can get quite large for shrubs, so 12 feet high, 10 feet wide. So choose the one that works for you and for your space. But they have beautiful white flowers, really attractive leaves, thick leaves with these deep veins that are just really pretty to look at. So viburnum, one to try. One of my favorites is the manzanitas. There are a few for you to choose from. Arctostaphylos is the scientific name on these. But we have in the upper left there, we have Panchito. Next to it on the upper right is the Chieftain. The Mock Bearberry is down in the lower left. And then another one that's not, the rest of these are plant select, but there's another one called Kinnikinick that's in the lower right there. These are all broadleaf evergreen shrubs. They're gonna hold those leaves through the winter. Most of these are gonna prefer that full sun, some handling a little bit more part shade. The Kinnikinick can handle that part shade quite well. But you know, this is one of those that you wanna let it grow naturally. Let it spread into its space, come into its area. It does not really like to be pruned very much at all. They do get these really pretty pink waxy flowers that you can see in that picture of the Panchito there. And then those will turn over into these nice red fruits toward the end of the season. The nice glossy green leaves are attractive, very uniform, and just, I think this is just a really good one. And this one can handle those low water conditions, those really low water conditions. Another one for you to consider is the Pawnee Butte sand cherry. This is a Colorado native selection. Sand cherries are native to Colorado, and this one was, I believe this one was selected up around the Pawnee Butte's national grassland, which is how it kind of got its name. But it's a shrubby ground cover, so kind of similar to the manzanitas. It's going to want to spread out wide. It's not going to get very tall, but it's going to fill in a good space. And so, you know, 2 feet tall maybe, but 6 feet wide or more. So again, give it room, give it some space, plan accordingly when you plant this. Very drought tolerant, tough as nails. I have grown these in a very, very low water landscape. Again, watering the first year to get it established, but then you can back off and it will get used to that environment. Another one though that you just want to prune sparingly or not at all. If you don't need to prune it, don't prune it. And it's going to also give you some really nice fall color and pretty spring flowers as well. I want to touch on another one for the shadier parts of your landscape. This one is Oregon grape holly. This one in particular is aquifolium. It's more of a larger shrub, but there's another one that's more of a ground cover, which is repens, R-E-P-E-N-S. There's some debate going on the name of this. I think it's getting moved over into a new category, so it may change from Mahonia to Berberis, but I don't know if that's happened yet. We'll see. But this is one of the few evergreens that we can grow that will tolerate that shade here in Colorado. If you're from the East Coast and you're used to seeing holly trees, this has a really similar look to a holly tree, except for the flowers and the berries are a little different. Yellow flowers and blue colored berries. So a really nice three-season plant, kind of like Alison mentioned earlier with the serviceberry. Just a really great one. And this one's going to, again, do well in that shade for you. I also want to mention junipers. I know junipers have, we've been using junipers for a long time. They may be a little overused in certain cases, but they really do well in our landscape. They're very hardy. They're very versatile. You can get these in lots of different shapes, forms, sizes, growth habits, colors. So moving from left to right, we have the Woodward columnar juniper on the far left, a Wichita blue juniper in the second picture there. I think the third one is buffalo, I'm not quite sure. And then some sort of a creeping juniper there off to the far right. But the range here is really great. Very drought tolerant, lots of varieties for you to choose from, and evergreen. So they're gonna keep that green color year round. Other shrubs that then you can try for your dry sites, things like blue mist spirea, boulder raspberry, and butterfly bush, those all have nice flowering characteristics to them. I've got a picture here of the Carol Mackey Daphne. This one is a great option for low water landscapes. It's a little tough to establish, so you got to give it a little extra care, make sure you give it the right site. Common lilac is one. I wish we had time to cover all these shrubs, we just don't. But common lilac is one that you can put into a low water landscape. It should do pretty well. A lot of the homesteaders brought lilacs out when they came. And so there are lilac plantings around that are quite old and doing just fine with all of that they've had to endure in Colorado. Currants, desert holly, those are a couple other options. The Japanese barberry could be one. It does have thorns, so just keep that in mind. Little leaf mock orange, mountain lover, that's a nice evergreen, almost a ground cover. And then we have mugo pine, privet, nine bark, New Mexico privet, I should say, nine bark, potentilla, red twig dogwood, rock spirea. The snowberry is in the lower right there. That's a nice one with very interesting berries to it, really pretty leaf on it. Skunkbush sumac and yucca. And this is not even the full list. There are still so many that you can incorporate into these drier sites. So Allison's gonna come back on. We're gonna move on into some sun-loving perennials and we'll go from there.
Thank you, Amy. So sun perennials, these are the ones for the really hot, dry parts of your landscape. So we're talking full sun, probably a minimum of 8 hours a day, maybe 6 hours a day, and then all the way into like a southern exposure where they are getting blasted by the sun on a regular basis. So the first one we'll talk about, and we actually, what we consider to be like the three biggies, or the three first ones I'll talk about, is penstemon. This is also known as beard tongue. And what's incredible about penstemon is the diversity, both in the flower look and also the color. So the four we have listed here from left to right are Grand Mesa, then we have Pike's Peak, and you can see the little butts of those bees sticking out. This is an amazing pollinator plant. All of these are going to attract pollinators, which is incredible. Firecracker is the red one, and then Carolyn's Hope, which is one of my favorites. So it was introduced by the Plant Select program, and it was for one of the breeders' wives who was diagnosed with breast cancer. So a portion of this plant's proceeds do support the breast cancer research and science that is going on, but it's also that perfectly pink flower. It's just absolutely beautiful. So penstemons are one that if you're not growing them, I would strongly encourage you to consider. The height ranges from 1 to 3 feet tall, and there are a bunch of varieties. So this is where homework for you is key. Your local garden centers might sell many of them. Some of them may not be hardy, especially if you're doing mail order or ordering seeds or things like that. So lots of different varieties out there. About 60 or so are actually native to Colorado. So if you do hike in the forest and the mountains, you'll probably run into penstemon. Bloom time ranges from anywhere from late spring to early summer. They usually have several weeks of bloom on there. Hummingbirds love it, bees love it, and they do tend to be deer resistant. I have rabbits, I bet most of you do, and I haven't noticed that these are being chewed by rabbits, so I would throw rabbits in there as well. The thing with penstemon is they really don't care for really heavy soils, so do try to put them in an area that does have better drainage, but they don't need fertilizer, they don't need a lot of supplemental water. Once established, again, we have to say every plant needs regular water until they are established. Can't hit that home enough. And again, full sun. The next one we'll talk about is salvia. And just in terms of floriferous bloom, salvias are at the top of the list. So let's learn a little bit more about the salvias. These are considered to be the ornamental sages. So while we eat sage, right, we have that with our turkey or other things, it's a big genus. And so there are ornamental types, and there are also edible types. So just don't go munching on all the salvias because it may not be a good thing. This is in the mint family, which may send a chill down your spine because we know that anything in the mint family can be aggressive and spread. The good thing about this is because we're going to likely keep them on the drier side, right? These are hot, dry, drought tolerant perennials. You're not going to have that issue. And actually, if you overwater salvia, they can rot out and get kind of dead in the middle. So definitely once established, start to wean off the water and keep them on the drier side. Mixing them with penstemon is an awesome idea. They go naturally well together. They kind of complement their bloom season so that you have a longer period of bloom because the salvias will bloom later into the summer. And again, the diversity in the flower color, the look are numerous with salvia. It's great. Very tolerant to a wide variety of soils. So if you're battling more of a heavy clay or maybe a new landscape, it's going to work for you. Very pollinator friendly. And the three we have pictured here, so we have Windwalker Royal Red, that's a Plant Select introduction. And you can see that unique flower. So it's very different than its friend to the right, which is May Night Salvia. She's been around for a very long time. She was a perennial plant of the year a number of years ago and really does well. Lots of blooms. What's cool about May Night Salvia is once she blooms for the first time, you can cut her back by about half and you'll get a second set of blooms, but not as much. And then in the lower bottom, we have the silver sage. The leaves, which you can barely see because we have so many white flowers, they're really large, they're fuzzy. This is a plant that gives you texture in the garden. So the flowers are just an added bonus, but the leaves themselves are really, really attractive. Our next perennial is hyssop, also known as agastache. That's how I pronounce it. These are fragrant in the landscape, which is really nice. So They smell a little bit like minty bubblegum. Some of them might smell like anise, that licorice flavor. Another one that is going to be super pollinator friendly with a huge diversity of flower colors that you have. So those three, the salvia, the hyssop, and the penstemon, are three that I think every garden should include in some way, shape, or form. Once established, you only need to water them rarely. And I have found that a couple of them gently reseed. So I have planted some hyssops, I let them complete their flower cycle, and then I find little baby hyssops the next year. They're not, by any stretch of the imagination, invasive. Okay, very easily controlled. So if they get out of where you want them, you can just remove them. Once the new growth emerges, this is really pretty true for all three of these plants. Once you start to see green at the base, you can cut back all of that, and then that will be what blooms the following or that season. The ones featured here, we have Sonoran Sunset, we have the blue hyssop, so that kind of bluish purple color again. Super pollinator friendly, and the fragrance is nice. Coneflower is one I think we're all familiar with, the echinacea. What's neat about coneflower is that we have a lot of breeding going into echinacea to make them just a little bit more interesting than the traditional lilac-y purple. Not that there's anything wrong with the old standard. Named appropriately because echinacea is Greek for hedgehog, and you can see how it got that name from kind of the center portion of the flower. This is a full sun plant. What you might find that happens is that echinacea does tend to reseed, and it can escape to areas of the landscape where you may not want it, or that could be a welcome addition. Just depends on what you want. I do recommend leaving the seed heads into the winter, fall and winter, just because it provides some interest. It provides a food source for some of the birds and other creatures, but very pollinator friendly. And a couple of cultivars for you to consider. These were all in the CSU perennial trials the last few years, and they have done exceedingly well. So again, what's great about echinacea is they have a really long, several weeks of bloom. They're a great cut flower. You can see how the flowers sit above the foliage, so you really get an impactful show. But there is a series called Kismet. That's that top left picture. So Kismet, there's a raspberry, there's a couple different ones. On the lower bottom, that's Sombrero Trace Amigos. And you can see that there's actually three different colors in there. So there's more of a magenta, there's a raspberry color, there's one that's a little bit darker. So just you get all the colors in one plant, which is great. And if you want something more cottage garden, you might go with Cheyenne Spirit, which again is going to have a mixture of colors with the yellows and the oranges and that kind of traditional lavender color. So coneflowers, look at them. There's more than just the standard purple. Hotflower oregano is one that's technically a ground cover. This is kind of a little guy. It might get about 18 inches tall, but this is grown because of the flowers. And so there's a bract, which you can see it's kind of that purpley green color. And then the flowers are those teeny tiny little purple guys. What's cool about hot flower oregano, this was a plant select introduction, I think back in maybe 2004. And it's great for cut flowers. It's pollinator friendly. It looks phenomenal in a rock garden or a crevice garden, or if you can position it over a retaining wall. And those bracts dry down and turn brown and look really great in the winter as well. Then in the spring, just cut it back when you start to see growth. It's just phenomenal. The next picture just shows off how cool this is. Again, it's more of a ground cover plant. It's not going to be 3 feet tall, but where it kind of fills in gaps in the garden, you can definitely use this. Hot full sun, pollinators love it. Doesn't seem to be a rabbit problem, so consider the hot flower. And lavender, which of course I have featured behind me, lavender is an incredible plant for Colorado. It's really versatile. So obviously, lavender can be used for many reasons. It can be for edibles, like if you're using it in baked goods. We use it a lot, of course, in beauty products like soaps and shampoos. And then it's just so attractive. This is absolutely beautiful. I love it. Maybe you've made the mistake of planting Russian sage. I have. We all have made that mistake. Lavender could be a good substitute if you are ever able to fully remove Russian sage from your garden. This is an herb that thrives in our alkaline soils, so our soil type does not affect this plant. It can take more heavy soils. And Colorado just seems to be a great place to grow lavender. It is winter hardy, has great blooms. What I would recommend is that you plant this in the spring. We found that fall planted lavender may not do as well. It needs just a little bit more time to get established and re-establish its root system. So I would say if you plan on adding lavender, do it this spring or early in the summer, give it some water to get established and then go from there. And there is one that is so cute. It is called We One. This is a plant select introduction and it's only about 12 inches tall. So if you're planting the traditional English types, they're going to be maybe in bloom about 16, 18 inches tall, maybe 20 inches with the flowers, but We One is just so cute in the little rock garden crevices. Oh, she's adorable. Plant We One, you can see one of the penstemons tucked behind her shoulder there. Sedums and the stone crops, all of the succulents. So I'm going to cover the sedums and then I'll talk about one succulent. These are amazing plants, right? They have adapted to hot, dry conditions. They have the ability to store water, to get through those really tough periods. They're great for rock gardens. They're great for hypertufas. They're great just in the landscape. I love sedums and one might say I'm obsessed. It's true. Every time I see a sedum in a garden center, I cannot pass it up. So I purchase it and then tuck it in. They can tolerate the poor rocky soils, but they can also do well in the typical clay too. A lot of them are ground covers. We have a couple that are more ornamentals that get to be about knee high. The ground cover types have flowers that I don't love them, but they are cute. I just like the foliage because they're so unique. You can see this diversity of the foliage where we have ones that are maybe a little more cupped and then we have that some that look more like rosettes. And the flowers do attract bees if you want to keep them. So a couple of different cultivars that you can consider. Winter Fire is my new obsession. This is what it looks like in the winter months. So it's green, like a dark green, like a CSU green during the summer. And then it gets this beautiful red fall color. Who would ever think that would happen with a sedum? Turquoise tails is another plant select introduction. Again, the flowers, you may love them, you may not like them. Planted with the agave in the background. Hello, it's amazing. But turquoise tails is more of a, let's say like kind of a clumpy, very unique structure. Autumn Joy is one of the ones that gets to be about knee tall. And what's great about Autumn Joy is it blooms later on into the fall. So this is one that blooms in August or September. Great pollinator plant because at that point, we may not have a lot of flowers left in our garden. Those flower heads are huge and heavy. They're almost like cabbages sitting on top of a plant. And they do persist into the winter months, which is wonderful. So you get that really nice winter structure. And then Angelina, you've probably heard of during the summer, she is a bright lime green. And then in the fall and winter, she gets these russets and oranges and just phenomenal. Angelina, Winter Fire together, I think it'd be an incredible duo. So anywhere, a couple of sedums for you to consider. And then I do want to call attention to the hens and chicks because if you want to start collecting something, maybe this is the collection for you. At least it is for me. There is a bunch of hen and chicks that have been introduced under the name Chick Charms. And there's a ton of diversity to them. You can just see the kind of diversity. So different variegation, different looks. They have super fun names like Mint Marvel and Appletini. There's one called like Cherry Cordial. They are great. They are commonly found in the garden center. You can find the sedums or the hens and chicks there. They have the typical hens and chicks, but maybe add some of these just for a little bit of diversity. And then I will wrap up with just a couple of grasses and some other suggestions of plants. Blonde Ambition Blue Grandma is a great grass, 36 inches tall. This is a native, a selected native, does great in unirrigated areas, but cannot tolerate the shade. This has been planted everywhere. You will run into this in your travels among the Front Range and beyond. Really hardy up to 9,500 feet as well. And then the next grass is switchgrass. This is Panicum. Great grasses, lots of different cultivars like Heavy Metal and Shenandoah, which is in the lower right. Northwind was introduced by the University of Minnesota. Nice narrow form, very respectful, does not spread, which is good. And then the flowers look like fireworks dancing or cotton candy being spun above those grasses, about 5 feet tall though. So do make sure that you have adequate room for this one. And a few more grasses for sun areas. Amy will cover those in shade. Blue oak grass, little blue stem, that's another native. So there's big blue stem, little blue stem. They do get some nice fall color, which you can see there. Prairie drop seed, kind of a mop top. Really, really cool. And then Indian grass. So these are all full sun grasses. We have a great fact sheet on ornamental grasses that John, Darren, or Lisa could pop into the chat for you. So do check those out and then select one that works best for your conditions.
All right. Great, Alison. Thanks for the sun-loving perennials. Let's talk a little bit about some shade-loving perennials. So dry shade is one of those areas that it's a niche, and it's hard to sometimes think of plants that you can put into a dry shade situation. Let's start out with Denver Gold Columbine. I love this plant. I love columbine in general. You know, it is our state flower. This yellow form, though, called Denver Gold, one thing that makes it different from the normal Rocky Mountain columbine is that it blooms almost the whole summer, from June through September. Much longer than your blues and your reds. You can also cut those blooms back periodically. That can help encourage new blooms. It is a native to the Southwest. It is a plant selection. Just a really nice, good way to have some pop of color, some brightness in those shady areas. You know, when you look at that lower picture there, your eye is drawn toward those yellow flowers, and it really makes you not want to look back at that dark understory shade area. It just gives it that bright pop that the area needs. Another columbine that you could use, this is another plant select variety, is Swan Violet and White, or called Remembrance. This one is much better in the part shade. The Denver Gold can actually go either way, sun or shade. This one likes to have a little bit more shade than that. Not quite as tall, but man, those flowers are striking. They have that really deep, dark purple toward the back on the bracts, and then those white petals and that yellow center just really showing off very well. These will benefit from a little bit of moisture, but one thing to think about with shade is that you're going to get that moisture retention just for the fact that you're in the shade. So, but giving these just a little bit of irrigation can help give them a bigger and better display, but they will also do okay with a lack of water too. Johnson's Blue Cranesbill. This is kind of a one-off plant. This one here that we want to mention, really great plant, full sun to full shade. So a big range again here in where it can grow, and it can fit that niche. It's going to also bloom late spring and then last all the way up into early fall. So giving you that full season of color, beautiful little periwinkle blue flowers. The leaves are very attractive with their finely cut pattern to them. It does get a little bit of fall color. This one does like that sandy soil or just a more normal soil. But, you know, I've seen this one grown in so many different locations, and it seems to be very well adapted. So Johnson's Blue, this is a perennial geranium. It's not the typical annual geraniums that you're buying, you know, to put into your hanging baskets. This is a perennial type. So Johnson's Blue, give that one a try. One of my favorites for the dry shade garden is coral bells. And as you can see, the variety of options here, there's just so many. So sun to full shade again, really they like that shade more so. You'll get a more vibrant color in the shade, especially with some of these lime and yellow types. Very attractive leaves. There's been a lot of breeding going on with these type of plants. There's a nursery on the West Coast called Terra Nova. I had I was just so lucky to get to go visit it. And the plants that they're creating there, it's like they can come up with another one. And then there's another one. Some of these have variegated leaves. Some are dark purple. Some are pink. Some are green. It's just so many things you could do. You could have a whole section with just coral bells and really make it look really kind of cool. Let's see. So you can cut those flowers off. They do sit above the foliage, maybe up to 18 inches. You can cut those off periodically. That can help extend that bloom time. But like some of the other plants Alison mentioned, these are really grown more for the foliage. One of my favorites is the one up here in the upper left. That's Snow Angels Coral Bells. Palace Purple is the one off to the right here. And then just, again, so many others. Here's some of those options for you. There's that Snow Angel again. Palace Purple is a very popular one. And then there's this Carnival series with these really nice leaves with kind of this mottled look to them, and Lime Marmalade. Again, if you want to add that brightness into your shade, choose these yellows and lime greens to do that. Siberian Bugloss or Brunnera is another option. Now there is a Brunnera that's a little bit more invasive. This is a different kind. It's a Siberian Bugloss. Particularly this one called Jack Frost. And these are great. These will do great in part to full shade. They'll be more of like a ground cover, like a large leaf ground cover if you plant them in mass. Little tiny blue flowers that are just so delicate and dainty. And they come in the spring and you just love them. But then once those flowers kind of fade, you've got that beautiful variegated foliage behind it to carry you through the rest of the season with some interest. Very hardy here. Again, Jack Frost is the one up here in the top. And then Alexander's Great was a winner of the CSU trials that have much bigger leaves. Lady's Mantle, another one for the dry shade garden. This one has nice, big, large, fuzzy leaves. And if you do water or we get a little bit of rain, the water droplets sit on the top of those leaves and they shine and they become a little bit iridescent. And it's just really a cool thing to see. Little tiny little chartreuse flowers sitting above that, not too noticeable. Those will happen in the early summer, but this is just a really nice, can handle that full shade, can handle those drought conditions. Lady's Mantle is definitely one to try. And then one of my favorites is hardy plumbago or leadwort. I have this one growing at my house and it loves the shade. It's a nice little plant. Green leaves, bright blue flowers. It will hold its blooms all through the summer into the fall. And then you get this pop of red color at the end of the season. And that red against that blue, it just really stands out. This one can also be grown as a ground cover. It likes our soils. It likes any kind of soils, really pretty adaptable and pretty low water once you get this one established. Like some of the ones Alison mentioned, plant this in the spring, like you do your lavender. It's going to help it establish that root system better. And then finally, just a few grasses for your dry shade areas. Blue fescues can handle partial shade. That's the picture up here in the upper left. Blue oat is kind of a bigger version of the blue fescue, a little bigger there. Korean feather reed grass, you can get that one. It'll do great in partial shade. The little blue stem Alison mentioned will do good in the sun. It will also take some light shade. We have overdam reed grass here on my lower left. That's a variegated form of our friend Carl Forrester. So if you have Carl Forrester reed grass, you'll see it everywhere. It's green on the bottom and kind of a straw color on the top where the seed heads are. And it's just a lot overplanted. And so the overdam could be a nice option to replace the Carl Forrester. And the variegation will show up better in the shade. The shade kind of brightens those colors, more saturation to those colors. And then the lower right there, again, prairie drop seed. So good for the sun, but can also handle that light shade as well. So we're going to wrap it up with our last couple minutes. We just want to remind you about right plant, right place, and what does it really mean? It means using that space, finding the purpose of that space, choosing the right plants, and then placing them where they want to be. Instead of modifying your landscape, let's just modify our plant palette and work with our gardens instead of against them, making sure that they have the growing conditions that they need. Again, I just want to mention that we've got several resources out there. Go visit those public gardens. We've shown you a few pictures today where you can go and see those. You can also find on Plant Select's website, they have a list of Plant Select gardens around the state. Most Plant Select plants are going to be low water, highly adapted. And so you can find out where there is a Plant Select xeric garden near you and then go visit. Tons of stuff from CSU. Check out our blog. I'm going to bring Alison back on and our panel. Do we have any last minute things we need to cover or questions that are still hanging out there?
I just want to remind people that this was recorded. If you're on this webinar, you've registered and you'll get the recording within a week or so.
Hey, Amy, since you're the dry shade person, we did have one just come in and talk about a shady spot that the only sun it gets is in the afternoon when it's that blazing western sun. Any thoughts about your favorite plants for that sort of situation?
Yeah, in fact, some of the ones that are sun loving will actually do probably better than a shade loving plant in that situation. I have grown on my west facing, the penstemons are gonna love that hot, hot afternoon sun, and they can actually handle just a little bit of that morning shade just fine. So you could try penstemons. Some of the bulbs would be great in that situation. But I think in the case of an afternoon sun, that's gonna be more impactful than the little bit of shade it gets in the morning. So let's choose more sun-loving plants for those areas.
Thanks, Amy. And then maybe both of you to weigh in on, Deborah would like to know, in terms of watering, do you recommend a drip system or some other kind of sprinkler system? How should we water things when they do need water?
Well, I know what John would recommend, and that would be no irrigation system, which I think
is why I asked you.
Yes, and I think that's definitely an option. As we've talked about today, you really need to water these the first year to get them established. If you can do that by hand, and you might be watering maybe once a week, maybe a couple times a week right after planting, but then maybe backing off to once a week and then just kind of tapering it down every couple weeks, you can eventually get to where that landscape will sustain itself. You'll lose some plants along the way. You'll replace them with more drought tolerant plants. And that's how you get to that zero water situation, but you can absolutely do drip on your low water landscape. You just want to make sure it's on its own zone so that you can turn it off when you need to, because you're going to be turning it off more than you're going to be turning it on. Alison, what do you think? Any other tips there?
No, that covered it perfectly.
Yeah. You can also use like a sprinkler, overhead sprinkler type situation. You just don't want to be doing that very often to where it's getting overwatered. So I have seen that too, but always backing off after they get established. So thank you everyone for joining.